Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Dinosaurs On Campus. May we have your warm welcome to tonight's master of ceremonies, Daddy Dinosaur, Mr. Wim van Humbeek.
They share a small common ancestor called Euparkeria. And it lived about 250 million years ago. I'm saying eubacteria, but it's animals like eubacteria. They looked a little bit like this animal. And to explain the story, I have to explain a little bit the basics, because evolutionary biologists and paleontologists, they like to think in trees. So if you see an image like this, you can tell for sure that these animals are evolutionary biologists, paleontologists. Of course, we don't have to take it this literal, because when we mean trees, we actually mean evolutionary trees, relationships between animals and groups of animals. And this is, of course, based on the thought of Darwin, who embraced early on this idea of a common ancestor, based on, in a population, in a group of animals, birds, birds are animals, of course, animals, plants, and organisms in general, there's variation. And because environments can change, they can have a differential influence on these different variants in that population. And of course, this is going to drive selection towards certain features of those organisms. And then, through time, organisms will evolve as the environment changes. Now, in the old days, they pretty much just drew a tree with what they thought were the interrelationships. Like Ernst Haeckel was one of the early, he put humans right all the way on top, because we're so grand design. Probably he would have put white, straight humans on top. but today we go a little bit more objective. What we do today is we use traits. We study organisms, their features, and then we give them scores. So in this example here, I have six animals: a lizard, platypus, zebra, bear, tiger, and a lion. And we can define certain traits that group them together more and more closely. Like, for example, all these animals have five fingers, claws, but the lizard doesn't have fur or doesn't produce milk. The platypus doesn't have placenta and is not live-bearing. The zebra doesn't have carnassial teeth, which are basically teeth that evolved, they're the molars that evolved to cut meat. And the bear doesn't have retractable claws. And we can use that information to build a data matrix. So we give a 1 or a 0 if a character is present or absent. And in the case of multi-state characters, we can even go up to as many numbers as you like. If we don't know, we put a question mark. That's a pretty objective way of working around these issues. Now, this is another example. This is actually something that I took from the literature. In paleontology, we rely very strongly on morphological features. So we look at physical characters. In biology, we would use also molecular data. We would look at DNA, we look at structure of the genome and all that. But you can actually combine it. If you combine fossils and recent animals, you can study their evolution and combine them in those matrices. And then we put that matrix in a computer, and the computer will calculate the most logical steps between changes of those characters. And this is what it will spit out, a tree. We call this, in more scientific terms, a cladogram. And every time a trait is gained, we go to a new, great hamburgers, by the way. Every time we have this split, we call this a node. So here, we call this node. Every animal that is linked to this node and branches off is an amniote, because it has an amniotic egg, an egg that is surrounded by a membrane. And then here we have the mammals. The lizard is not a mammal. Up here we go into placental mammals, and up here we have carnivores, and up here we have felids. There's no particular hierarchy in this. Incidentally, and also I marked the characters every time, this is the same tree, but we just draw it differently. I just want to show you that you can draw these evolutionary trees in different ways, just to get your point across what are the interrelationships between these different organisms. Let's talk a little bit about time, because we also have to situate these cladograms, these trees in time. And we, of course, are going to talk about dinosaurs, but just to give you a quick recap, if you were to put the origin of the Earth
at the shoulder height, then the first animals with real mineralized skeletons, they would only appear at the first knuckle. So that's a long period of time for evolution to take place. And then dinosaurs, I won't show you my middle finger, but it's the last knuckle on your middle finger, basically. From right before to right after. And then humans, right at the very tip of your fingernail, that's where we look. Of course, for scientists, this is a little bit too unprecise to discuss these scientific problems, which is why us geologists use this stratigraphic chart. And this is, of course, based on a lot of work that has happened over 200 years, and basically go around the Earth and define layers. For today, I mostly want to focus on this part of the stratigraphic chart, which is the Mesozoic. We live here in the Cenozoic, right at the end of the Holocene, so people even call it the Anthropocene. But we're mostly interested in the Mesozoic, and it starts with the Triassic, then comes the Jurassic. Some people will know this from a certain movie franchise, which we'll hear about later on, probably. And then at the end, we have the Cretaceous. So there's three important time periods that are relevant to the evolution of dinosaurs. In that time, now this is basically the entire stratigraphic charts that I showed you in time, reflected on continental, drift is the wrong word, it's plate tectonics. It's basically accelerated what the Earth looked like 600 million years ago here, 250 now. So it's like in the blink of an eye, 600 million years of evolution. This is going to have tremendous impacts on climate, on ocean circulations, on all kinds of environmental parameters that will have an influence on evolution, of course. Let's go back to our chicken. I don't have time today to talk really about the origin of chickens. The first chickens evolved somewhere 8,000 years ago in Southeast Asia. I'm going to go way further back in time to actually before this happened. Melanie will tell you more about that, I'm sure, and maybe Kim also. I want to talk about right before the extinction event, because a couple years ago this creature was found. It was found by accident because it had sat in a collection for 20 years, and then somebody said, yeah, it might be interesting, let's put it in a CT scanner. It was basically a clump of rock, and inside the rock there seemed to be little bits of bone, and when they did the CT scan, this very nice skull came out. And it appeared to belong to a bird that is very close to the ancestor of galliforms or anseriforms. The galliforms, that's chickens, pheasants, all kinds of tasty birds, and then the anseriforms, it's geese and ducks, also quite tasty birds. And this animal would be close to those. So there would be chicken-like birds already in right way before the dinosaurs died out. So I wonder what it tasted like, probably very similar. So we have all these chicken-like features, beak, short tail, wings without claws. If we go a little bit further down this tree, remember the trees, we go down, we find here archaeotrichs. That's the next one I want to talk about. So this is considered a bird. But if we look closer, you'll see it has a long tail, it has claws on its fingers. Actually, I have one here. This is not a real one. The real one in Berlin is insured for about 10 million euros, so I wouldn't be walking around with it. If you have time later on, I'll put it here. Check it out, close by. So it has a long tail, claws on the hands, and teeth in its mouth. That's not very bird-like. These are reptilian characters. This is an animal that really shows the pedigree of dinosaurs. Incidentally, some of these features also appear in developing birds. Birds that are still in the egg, they still show these claws, they show a long tail, and that then, grows out as the animal develops further. Incidentally, I want to say this feather was already discovered in 1862, only about 20 years after Darwin published his Origin of Species. So, I think a few years later, this one was found. people could have realized that birds are dinosaurs way before the 1990s when a bunch of Chinese material was discovered. So, we keep moving through our phylogeny. This is very close to that where the Archaeopteryx is situated. These are dromaeosaurs, or raptors, as they're called in the movie franchise. And these are probably the most feared dinosaurs because we know that they had a certain level of intelligence, bird-like intelligence. And if you look at their bones, you will see that on their forearms they have these buttresses. They have little bumps on the forearm that we also recognize in birds because those are what we call the quill knobs, where the primary feathers attach to the wing. So these are dinosaurs with bird-like characters. And we actually published one a couple of years ago, 2017, I think. this is Hoskinapter. Quite proud of it because it's a very... When I first saw this fossil, it's a very nice specimen. It's only maybe this big. I thought it was a fake. I thought that somebody had put the skull of a seagull on top of some kind of raptor-like animal, but then it turned out to be authentic. It actually has very tiny teeth still in the jaw. It's a very, very interesting specimen. This is just to illustrate how wrong the movies are. Supposedly, at the time when they first designed these creatures, it was too expensive to render the feathers. And they kept their story straight and they just stuck with the ugly monster. So this is just a recap of what you just saw. Up here we have the birds, here we have Archaeopteryx, and here are all those raptors connected to. And we are moving all the way down the tree, we're going back to crocodiles. Just to show you that this is very dense. Now when we talk about missing links, there aren't that many missing links anymore. Okay, going down the phylogeny further. No talk is complete without this animal. On dinosaurs at least. This is Tyrannosaurus Rex. So all the animals before, they had feathers. Show your hands if you think that Tyrannosaurus Rex had feathers. A few hands. Yeah? So, something like that. Very cute, Tyrannosaurus. I don't know if we're still... I'm still going for it. You may laugh, but we have found a feathered Tyrannosaur. In the early Cretaceous of China, T-Rex is late Cretaceous, 66 million years. This is 60 million, almost 60 million years older. We have this feathered Tyrannosaur, and it has all these not feathers as you would expect in a bird, but some plumaceous structures. And of course, it's because it's living very north. It's living in northern, it was living in, at the time, northern China. Very cold. So those feathers are, in essence, to stay warm. And that's why those structures evolved in the first place. Question remains, is Tyrannosaurus Rex feathered? I don't know. We haven't found any evidence. It lived in a very tropical, hot environment, so maybe not, because it would overheat. But baby Tyrannosaurus might have had some. Imagine a downy, cute little Tyrannosaurus. Okay, so recap. I mean, I could talk to you all day about all these wonderful creatures that are on the street, but we have only maybe 10 minutes left. So here's T-Rex. We go down further. We meet Allosaurus, the great carnivorous dinosaur of the Jurassic. Scary animal, very interesting. That creature, very different than Tyrannosaurus. Some people mistake it for a Tyrannosaurus, had much flatter teeth. Maybe more famous in recent years, especially with kids, is this creature, Spinosaurus. Lots of discussion going on whether it was a fully aquatic one or whether it was living kind of a heron-like approach near the water and then hunting fish from the side. A lot to do about its paleobiology. Very interesting animal. And specimens of species of this group, Spinosauridae, are found all over the world. We have one. We have some in England, like this Baryonyx. And we have a thumb claw of this in the raffle. So if you haven't bought a raffle ticket, you have a chance of winning the 3D print of the thumb claw of Baryonyx. So this is Baryonyx on the tree. Notice that it's more primitive than the Allosaurus that is here, yet they are Cretaceous later, and Allosaurus is Jurassic. Why then branching off higher up in the tree. I'll get to that right here. If we then plot those trees on a timetable, we see that it does make sense. That Allosaurus, that the branches must have just been pushed way further in the past. What's interesting about this is that we can see certain patterns of evolution here in the Jurassic, major branching off. If we would split up this tree of Aviellans, you would see a major branching off in the Cretaceous. And you see similar features with other dinosaurs, plant-eating dinosaurs. And this, of course, leads you to thinking about, maybe there were other things happening there, environmental changes that are linked to this evolution. And this is what paleontologists are really interested about. Another talk to talk about those environmental changes, because we have to go further down the tree. I could not stop, so we're zooming out. This is a dinosaur tree. We have talked mostly about these theropods, so the birds would be, if you go up this tree, there would be the birds. I'm taking a little side branch into the sauropods, because they have big animals. We have a thigh bone right there. That's a thigh bone of an Atlasaurus that lives in Morocco in the Jurassic. That's not even a big one. The biggest ones would be near 80 to 100,000 kilograms living in South America. And these are the largest mammals, terrestrial mammals that ever lived. So we're talking terrestrial. Interesting about these animals, I don't want to say too much about them because, again, time. And it was a little bit speculation in the Prehistoric Planet series, these air sacs. I mean, they make them bulge out as a sort of a sexual display feature. I think it's a little bit over the top. They're very fragile in that way. But they did have very hollow vertebrae. If you scan, take a scan, these vertebrae are very hollow. They are all kinds of, air sacs attached to the side. And they are basically connections to the lung. And this is also what birds have. It's what we call the bird avian-style lung. And I couldn't make the animation work in a loop, so I have to press it back and forth. But if a mammal does an inhalation, an exhalation, it's a one-way circuit. You inhale, gas exchange, and exhale, and the air is out. With a bird, because of all the air sacs, it takes up a lot more air than can actually fit in the lung. And so some of the air is stored in the air sacs as air passes through the lung. Gas exchange happens, the air is exhaled, and the stored air is pushed through the lung again, and you get gas exchange again. So you get double the efficiency for breathing. And this is a system that allows birds to fly at 10,000 meters altitude and not suffocate. More efficient lung. we keep going. You see that there's another branch, whole diverse branch of dinosaurs, which I won't go into detail, just show you that these are some of the more iconic representatives, and a major difference between those two groups, those two clades of dinosaurs, is what their pelvis looks like. So we have a hip bone right here, we call it the ilium, and this is the pubis, and the bone you sit on, that's the ischium. In the long-necked dinosaurs, the sauropods and the theropods, the pubis is pointing forwards and the ischium is pointing backwards. Whereas in the ornithischians, the pubis is always pointing backwards, parallel to the ischium. Ironically, birds belong to the lizard-hipped dinosaurs, because that's what this translates to, and not bird-hipped dinosaurs. I was always confused about this as a kid, but this is a feature of convergent evolution. As birds became more flying, their bone structures evolved to accommodate a lot more musculature that is needed for this active flapping flight. And that's why their pubis started to revert backwards. But that's much higher up in the theropod tree. Okay, moving back further in the tree of archosaurs. These are, now we're getting to the crocodile realm. Because at the beginning of the Jurassic and at the end of the Triassic, there was another major mass extinction. And this has to do with the start of the opening of the northern Atlantic Ocean. A lot of volcanism associated with climate change, and there's an entire group of crocodile-like animals, of which modern-day crocodilians are the only remnants that disappeared. And in the wake of their disappearance, dinosaurs could actually take over. The major difference between crocodile-like archosaurs, as they're called, and dinosaur-like archosaurs, is the structure of the ankle. Dinosaurs, they have a straight ankle, only moves that way, and keeps their legs straight under the body. This gives you an energy advantage. The locomotion is much more efficient, you don't have to use musculature to push yourself up and keep running. That being said, there were terrestrial crocodiles, and there was a major diversity in the Jurassic of this part of the archosaur tree, which I don't have time to get into, because I want to get to this animal, Euparkyria, which is all the way at the bottom, at the stem of the tree of archosaurs. And it's thanks to this, I almost want to call it a crocodile raft, because it's an opportunistic animal. It evolved also in the wake of an extinction, the Permian-Triassic extinction, which was the mother of all extinctions. You think the dinosaur extinction was bad, the Permo-Triassic extinction was a lot worse. And in the wake of that extinction, this group of animals that looked like Euparkyria, agile, fast, carnivorous, small animals that could eat about anything they wanted, were opportunistic and saw their chance and then took over from the animals that lived before the Permo-Triassic extinction. The Permo-Triassic extinction also related to volcanism, climate change, and loss of habitats. If we go even further back in time, so here we have all crocodiles, all birds collected in the archosaur tree, Euparkyria. And then you can start to pinpoint in all the other reptiles that we know today that branched off and had their own evolution. And we even go further back down to see the branching off of where we come from. But that's another story. Chris will tell you something about our own deep time ancestors. And I won't get in his way. So to conclude, crocodiles and birds, they do share a common ancestor. Probably looked something like this. Buy my book. It's for sale. English version with a single bone on it. Dutch version. We also have casts of teeth and claws for the Dutch speakers. We have a podcast. My friend has just got a baby, so episode 6 will maybe be a little bit of a wait. And thank you for your attention.
Hello everybody. I'm very sorry I'm not doing my talk in Dutch because my English is quite
even gestudeerd heb en al jaren met wetenschappelijke dingen bezig zijn en ik die eigenlijk ga praten over een film speelgoed in een roze kerst. Dat is eigenlijk de komende 20 minuten. Ik heb inderdaad een boek geschreven. Ik zal misschien even vertellen hoe ik op het idee ben gekomen. Ik ben zelf geen wetenschapper. Ik ben gewoon geïnteresseerd in heel veel dingen. Op een bepaald moment was ik met mijn vrouw op weg naar een concert. Er zijn fans van Stromae in de zaal toevallig. Drie. Ik was naar Stromae op weg in Werchter op het festival en we stonden een beetje in de file. En op dat moment stond er een grote, gigantische Ford Raptor. Ik weet niet of iemand dat kent, dat is een gigantische pick-up wagen van Ford. Die stond voor ons en die naam spreekt me wel in het oog. En bij mij is er zoiets geknipt in mijn hoofd en ik dacht, ja, dat is eigenlijk wel gek hoeveel dingen er met dino's te maken hebben. Je kan eigenlijk geen winkel meer binnenkomen, je kan nergens meer zijn. Bedragen ze, we rijden er hier rond, we eten ze op. Dino's zijn overal. En dat is eigenlijk voor mij een beetje de trigger geweest om er iets mee te doen. Het is eigenlijk een beetje, ja, ik bedoel, dit is maar een kleine greep uit het aanbod. Natuurlijk zijn er mensen met dino onderbroeken toevallig. Daarmee heb ik alles gezegd eigenlijk. Nee, dat is voor mij de trigger geweest om er iets mee te doen. Ik heb vooral gezocht naar heel veel leuke verhalen die ik tegengekomen ben over ja, hoe dino's eigenlijk zelf ons leven soms bepalen. De manier waarop, ga ik straks over vertellen, de manier waarop we keuzes maken in de winkel bijvoorbeeld, heeft er ook heel erg mee te maken. De vraag die ik soms krijg, en ik was daar heel verbaasd over, ik weet niet of jullie die soms nog krijgen, maar ik kreeg soms de vraag naar aanleiding van mijn boek, kregen wij zelfs een journaliste die, wat ik dacht, een wetenschappelijke achtergrond had, die plots in het voorgesprek tegen mij vroeg van ja, zo, ze hebben toch een tijdje geleden toch bij dino's ontdekt die ook samen met de mensen hebben geleefd, hè? En dacht, ja, dat is niet. Bestaat uiteraard niet, het ongeveer een dikke, bijna 60 miljoen jaar tussen, maar goed. Mijn antwoord daarop is vaak, het is een beetje de schuld van de Flintstones. Dat is eigenlijk, dat is goed bedoeld, ik vind de Flintstones de max, maar in de jaren 60 is het een beetje fout gelopen. Want eigenlijk wat heel veel mensen, wat heel veel schrijvers, heel veel bedenkers doen, is natuurlijk een manier vinden om die uitgestorven dieren terug in ons leven te krijgen. En er is niks leukers als een manier vinden om dino's eigenlijk samen te laten leven met mensen, want dan wordt het leuk, dan is er interactie. Ik denk dat je ze niet graag op straat zou willen tegenkomen, de meesten die wij kennen, maar het is wel cool dat het kan. Ja, heel veel boeken, heel veel films zijn ook op dat idee gebaseerd van, zou het niet fijn zijn als? Ja. De Flintstones hebben dat eigenlijk ook op die manier aangepakt en dat is voor mij zo'n beetje, ja, het gebeurde daarvoor natuurlijk ook, ga ik het zo meteen jullie laten zien. Maar eigenlijk op grote schaal hebben de Flintstones een beetje de toon gezet, zal ik zeggen. Als je de serie ooit gezien hebt, die is tot in de deur uitgesproken, denk ik misschien nog, dat weet ik eigenlijk niet. Maar dat is eigenlijk, dino's, op een bepaald moment zijn dino's en mensen ook gewoon collega's op het werk. Hè. Dus het is een soort van hijskraan waar dan Fred Flintstone opklimt en die grijpt dan dingen met zijn bek. Dat is dan een langnek dino. Of die zetten de kegels terug bij de bowling. Dat soort voorbeelden hebben bij de Flintstones wel vaak. De dieren die iets meer pech hebben, die belanden in een restaurant. Dat zijn de Bronto Burgers. Het is een brontosaurus, er is veel vlees aan, dus daar eten ze wel eens op. En we kennen waarschijnlijk Dino ook wel. Zo'n beetje de huishond eigenlijk, hè, van de familie Flintstone. En Dino is eigenlijk een beetje, ja, dat is de enige Dino die in huis maakt. Dat is wel een beetje het concept. Dus voor mijn part is het daar een beetje al begonnen, waarom mensen soms denken van, ja, er is toch nog een beetje verwarring rond en wij nu samenleeft of niet. Maar vooral het leuke is dat het heel veel films en heel veel boeken en heel veel series, dat het kan. Ja. Mensen hebben altijd een manier proberen zoeken om die dieren in ons leven terug te krijgen. Nu, het leuke daaraan is, wat voor mij een beetje een ankerpunt is geweest in de geschiedenis van als we het over films hebben bijvoorbeeld, het is een heel oude film, het is niet te verwarren met de tweede film van Jurassic Park, heeft er niks mee te maken, maar The Lost World is eigenlijk een boek, oorspronkelijk, van Arthur Conan Doyle. Zijn er mensen die Arthur Conan Doyle een beetje kennen? Ja, toen een aantal vallen kijk, maar vooral vermoedelijk van Sherlock Holmes, de wereldberoemde detectieve, dat heeft hij bedacht, maar hij heeft ook The Lost World bedacht. En The Lost World is eigenlijk een beetje de verpersoonlijking van het idee, het onbereikbare. Ze komen op een bepaald moment in een Braziliaans regenwoud op een soort van plateau en daar leven toch wel geen dino's in. Hoe cool is dat? Dat professor Challenger die dan op weg gaat met zijn kornuiten, die daartoe komt in het regenwoud en die vindt dino's. Dino's die eigenlijk al, die zijn nooit uitgestorven, die leven daar gewoon.
En dat is eigenlijk natuurlijk voer voor heel veel leuke verhalen. Want dan kan je ermee aan de slag, dan kan je die ook in je wereld halen. Loopt soms eens fout, hebben we gezien, maar dat maakt het natuurlijk heel spannend. Ze hebben een jaar later een stoppenfilm, niet als in keiharde maar gewoon zonder gebed, van gemaakt. Het zit al een paar jaar later, 1925. En dat concept van The Lost World is gewoon superveel gekopieerd. Je gaat dat idee wel herkennen van, er is ergens een wereld, zelfs het hoeft niet eens op aarde te zijn. Het kan zelfs in de ruimte zijn, het kan zelfs onder de aardkorst zijn. In de kern van de aarde. Het zijn allemaal vergeten werelden, verdwenen werelden, die plots ontdekt worden. En meestal hebben schrijvers dan de neiging om daar een soort van mammoet in te steken, en zeker ook dino's. Omdat dat natuurlijk heel veel mensen aanspreekt. Wat een belangrijke, je ziet hier op de foto bijvoorbeeld twee dino's die zijn gemaakt. De techniek die ze toen gebruikten, waren natuurlijk lichtelijk anders. In de jaren 20, film stond nog niet echt op het punt waar we vandaag zijn. Nu, de techniek die vooral toen gebruikt werd, is stop-motion. Stop-motion wil zeggen, je maakt poppetjes, je beweegt die heel klein, heel zachtjes, heel kleine bewegingjes, en je maakt telkens een foto van die nieuwe beweging. Opnieuw en opnieuw en opnieuw. En op 24 keer per seconde laat je die projecteren. En dan krijg je eigenlijk een soort van film. Ja, dat is hoe de film eigenlijk werkt. We zien dat niet meer hoe we het vandaag kennen, maar dat is hoe de film gemaakt wordt. Dus stop-motion is eigenlijk, ik ga niet zeggen bedacht, maar een van de grondleggers is Willis O'Brien. En Willis was eigenlijk heel hard bezig met, hoe kan ik die poppetjes zo levensdicht mogelijk maken? Want je moet je voorstellen, als wij in 1993 naar de film gingen en voor het eerst Jurassic Park gingen kijken, dan was dat op dat moment de meest gekke dino's die je ooit gezien had. Dat was zo realistisch op dat moment, nog steeds trouwens, die mat ligt nog altijd heel erg hoog wat ze daarmee doen. Maar toen in de jaren 20 bestond dat niet, maar was dit de meest realistische manier waarop je dino's kon zien? Je kon niet Netflixen. Je had misschien boeken als je geluk had. Je kon af en toe naar de film, maar dit was voor mensen, de reactie van mensen toen was ongelooflijk. Die kwamen uit de bioscoop en die dachten, wat is dat? Als we daar nu naar kijken, denken we, ja, dat is gewoon een pop uit klei en doet dit. Maar dat was fantastisch, ja. En O'Brien heeft er eigenlijk mee voor gezorgd dat die hype eigenlijk op dat moment eigenlijk voor het grootste deel dan ontstaan is. Nu, stop motion is een van de technieken. Ja. Later kwamen de animatronics, dat zijn eigenlijk, laten we zeggen, robotdino's. Kan je zo uit de poppen, die mechanische bekken, die bewegen, die ken je ook uit Jurassic Park, worden ook wel mechanische poppen gebruikt. Daar werd dus een beetje met die techniek vooral. En de computermodellen natuurlijk. Maar dit, ik weet niet of je het goed kunt zien, maar dit is een aparte techniek. In 1940 was er een film die heette 1 Million BC. En toen dachten ze, wat is er nog realistischer dan een poppetje van klei? Dat is een ander beest. Wat hebben ze gedaan? Ze hebben een echte alligator genomen en ze hebben een echte iguana genomen en ze hebben die naast elkaar gezet. Ze hebben er een camera op gezet en ze dachten zo van, we gaan zien wat er gebeurt. Dat was geen goed idee. Ik heb geen idee, ik heb het niet teruggevonden of ze het overleefd hebben, dus ze zijn nog wel serieus beginnen vechten. Je kan dat ook zien als je die film ooit nog eens te pakken krijgt. Je kan trouwens ook zien, de alligator vonden ze niet dino genoeg, dus ze hebben een soort van vin op zijn rug gekregen. Ook dat nog. De leguaan vonden ze dan, dat is oké. Natuurlijk gerust. Sommige versies hebben ze ook nog zo een punt op hun neus geplakt, een soort van spike, die ze dan hadden gekeken van bij andere diersoorten. En ze hebben ooit nog gedacht dat dino's dat ook hadden. Dat de dino's dat ook hadden gehad, maar de leguaan hadden ze dat nooit gehad. Maar dat is eigenlijk gek, want ja, op dat moment, ze hebben daar zelfs een Oscar voor gewonnen. Beste visuele effecten, dit. 1940, moet ik er wel bij zeggen. Maar ja, dan krijg je dit. En uiteraard, zelfs toen al, in Groot-Brittannië waren er heel veel dierenrechtenorganisaties die toen al op hun achterste poten zijn gaan staan. En die hebben wel echt even ervoor gezorgd dat er heel veel scènes uit de film geknipt zijn. Ze vonden dat echt niet oké. Het was al een beetje te laat, maar goed, ze vonden niet oké dat aan het grote publiek zou vertoond worden. Dus hebben die scènes eigenlijk voor een groot deel te schrappen. Maar er zijn er natuurlijk wel een paar overgebleven, zoals deze. Dat gaat er redelijk heftig aan toe. Je moet er maar eens op YouTube vind je dit fragment bijvoorbeeld zeker weer terug. Het concept van dieren die dino's die samen met mensen leven, dat is een rode draad door heel veel dingen. Ja? Die grond, ik heb nu de Flintstones gehad, maar eigenlijk gingen mensen ook al in de jaren 20 natuurlijk op zoek naar hoe kunnen we ervoor zorgen dat dino's en mensen samen op één en dezelfde plek belanden. Dinotopia is zo'n heel mooi voorbeeld, vind ik zelf. Het is eigenlijk begonnen als een geïllustreerd fantasyboek van James Gurney. En zijn idee was eigenlijk, hij ging heel vaak op pad met... Hij was gefascineerd door National Geographic. Hij vond die tijdschriften bij zijn vader bijvoorbeeld, of bij zijn ouders thuis in de bibliotheek. En hij las heel graag die boekjes. En op een bepaald moment is hij erin geslaagd om zelf voor National Geographic te kunnen gaan werken. En hij sprak natuurlijk met heel veel archeologen, paleontologen, geologen. En die verhalen gingen ook vaak na een tijdje over zo'n verdwenen werelden. Je hebt Atlantis, je hebt El Dorado, een beetje fictieve werelden die nooit hebben bestaan, maar het fascineert wel heel erg. En op dat moment is bij hem een beetje een molentje beginnen draaien, denk ik. En heeft hij eigenlijk zelf daar Utopia bedacht. En dat is eigenlijk een stad waar mensen en dino's op een vredevolle manier, want dat kan, samenleven. Dat zijn prachtige tekeningen die, eigenlijk, die je in boeken zien. Later hebben ze ook een tv-serie van gemaakt. Je kent misschien, ik weet niet of hij groot genoeg is, maar de man hier rechtsonder, met zijn kleine dino op zijn arm. Dat is Wentworth Miller, de acteur, die je misschien van Prison Break nog kent. Dit is voor de hele plattegrond van de gevangenis op zijn lijf, dat doet hij. Dat is het jaar ervoor eigenlijk. Ja. In ieder geval zijn eerste bekende rol. Klein filmpje uit 1993, niet veel mensen hebben dat toen gezien. Jurassic Park is natuurlijk een beetje een instituut geworden na al die jaren. Heeft de lat heel hoog gelegd en die lat zijn ze alleen maar blijven hoger leggen in het maken en het vertellen van films. Wat ik graag wil is heel veel te vertellen over Jurassic Park. Koen heeft het ook al even aangehaald van de dingen die allemaal al dan niet klopten in de film. Wisten ze toen al dat er veren op die raptors moesten zitten of niet? Waren ze gewoon lui? Kostte het te veel geld? Er zijn heel veel paleontologen die ook meegewerkt hebben aan de film, die ook heel veel fouten erop voorhand gelukkig nog uitgehaald hebben. Maar waar ik het vooral over wil hebben, is een, denk ik, iets minder bekend verhaal. De film heeft 2 Oscars gewonnen, maar waaronder die voor beste sound effects. Nu, de naam Alain Pierre zal jullie waarschijnlijk niet al te veel zeggen, maar de man woont hier niet veraf, hier in Brussel. En die man is en was eigenlijk een instituut in, laat ons zeggen, alles wat met geluidstechnieken en geluidjes en synchronisatie te maken heeft. Ja. Dus hij zorgde bijvoorbeeld voor heel veel geluiden van tekenfilms bijvoorbeeld. Hij maakte daar de synchronisaties voor, hij maakte geluidjes die nodig, je hebt heel veel geluid nodig als je alleen maar tekeningen hebt. De muziek, dat deed Alain Pierre al zelf. Nu, als je documentaires bekijkt over The Making of Jurassic Park, ja, dan ga je een aantal theorieën of een aantal uitleg krijgen van verschillende mensen over hoe zijn jullie nu eigenlijk op het idee gekomen, of hoe hebben jullie nu die geluiden van die dino's bedacht? Want eigenlijk strikt genomen, ja, we hebben ze nooit ontmoet, we weten eigenlijk niet helemaal, of zeker toen nog niet, hoe klonken die nu? Het is vaak nog altijd gisteren, heb ik begrepen. Hoe kan het dan? Jullie hebben toch op een bepaald moment moeten beslissen, hoe gaan we die dieren in godsnaam? We moeten een brul hebben, we moeten een soort van toeter hebben voor bepaalde langnekdino's. Ja, hoe gaan we dat doen? Nu, het verhaal gaat, er zijn verschillende versies, en deze versie ga je nooit op de extras of de dvd horen, maar ik vind het wel een heel fijn verhaal. Het is een verhaal dat Alain Pierre zelf verteld heeft. Alain Pierre zegt, op een bepaald moment, hij was een instituut in het wereld. Ja, in Hollywood kennen ze Alain Pierre. Oké, dan moeten we weten bijvoorbeeld. Op een bepaald moment zijn ze bezig aan de film en ze zoeken nog een soort van brul voor de T-Rex. Ze denken van, ja, we hebben die T-Rex willen, we moeten dat eens, hoe gaan we dat doen? Dat moet machtig, dat moet krachtig klinken, maar wat we nu hebben, dat is het niet. Dat is niet helemaal wat we graag willen. Ze bellen naar Alain Pierre en Alain Pierre zegt, geef mij even. En hij gaat naar zijn archieven en hij bedenkt plots, ik heb ooit een tijdje geleden hier in de weilanden rondom ons, heb ik koeien opgenomen. Gewoon op een paar honderd meter van zijn woonplaats, hij deed dat heel vaak, geluiden opnemen die hij tegenkwam. En hij had een koe opgenomen, een soort van, gewoon dit, dat is niet mijn beste versie, maar je weet wat ik bedoel. En op een bepaald moment dacht hij van, wacht eens even, die koe, er iets mee kan. Hij heeft die een beetje vertraagd. Hij heeft er een echo of twee op gezet, nog een paar effectjes. Hij heeft zijn toverdoos boven gehaald. En het verhaal gaat dat de brul is die je nog heel vaak hoort in de Jurassic Park, in Jurassic World zelfs, films. Moet maar eens gaan kijken naar Jurassic World. De allereerste, als je zo naar helemaal op tijd is gevoeld, doorspoelt en de allerlaatste brul, dat is heel makkelijk, gewoon een makkelijk momentje om te kiezen, dat is En dan denk je van ja, het zal wel wel NPI, oké, dat kan wel zijn. U heeft twee theorieën, verklaringen hoe dat, allee, dat, waarom dat soms bij hem terechtgekomen zijn en vooral ook of dat klopt. Hij zegt, op dat moment winnen we die Oscar voor beste soundeffect en heeft Steven Spielberg iedereen van het team van geluid opgebeld om ze persoonlijk te bedanken. Dus Alain Pierre krijgt in het midden van de nacht voor ons in België de telefoon van Steven Spielberg, die zegt Alain merci. Hij geloofde het eerst niet, maar hij heeft gezegd, je zei bedankt, het is graag gedaan. En vooral, elke keer als die bril wordt gebruikt, krijgt Alain Pierre nog een cheque van 3000 Amerikaanse dollar in zijn bus. Goeie koe, denk ik dan. Zijn er voetbalfans? Nee. Dat is niet. Mooi verhaal vind ik zelf. Dino's zijn overal, ook in de sport. Ja. Dino's zijn overal en niet heel veel, er zijn er een aantal. In het boek heb ik er een aantal gevonden. Die bespreken zijn een aantal teams die graag een dino als logo of mascotte kiezen. Je kan al raden waarom een dino is angstaanjagend. Om te beginnen, onoverwinnelijk, een beetje fantasie. Ja. Je kan er schrik voor hebben, nu dit exemplaar is heel guitig en daar ben je niet per se bang voor. Het is een heel mooi verhaal. Dit is nog steeds sinds 1994 de mascotte van Arsenal. De Britse topclub. Ja. Dit is de Gunnersaurus Rex. En de Gunnersaurus Rex is bedacht door een jongetje van 11. Peter Lovell. In 1994 schrijft de club een wedstrijd uit voor een nieuwe mascotte. En ze zeggen, kinderen, doe iets, maak ons een tekening. En we beloven, de winnaar wordt onze nieuwe mascotte. We gaan er een kostuum van maken, we gaan er petten en t-shirts van maken. En jij mag beslissen wat het wordt. Peter begint te tekenen en volgens hem zelf, ik heb hem uiteindelijk, Peter is nu eind de 30 en werkt in de gaming-industrie. En via de moderne wegen heb ik hem uiteindelijk te pakken gekregen. Ik heb hem mogen spreken voor het boek ook, dus hij vertelt het heel uitgebreid. En hij vertelt eigenlijk, het stond heel snel op. Zijn moeder bewaarde nog altijd de keukentafel waarop hij de tekening heeft gemaakt, als een soort van reliquie, omdat er die dag voor hem en zijn familie heel veel is veranderd. Hij heeft die tekening gemaakt. En dat is wat het geworden is. Deze is Peter, 11 jaar. Met zijn tekening, die hij voor mij proper ingescand heeft, doorgestuurd. Want hij hangt nog altijd in zijn huis, heeft hij achteraf teruggekregen. Maar je ziet, dat gaming ding dat zit er al wat in. Hè. Normaal gezien maak je 1-2-3 tekeningen. Nee, we gaan ook de front en de zijkant even meegeven. Dat vond ik ook. Dit is de Gunnersaurus Rex, ze zijn er redelijk goed op. Allee, het is realistisch in de zin van ze zijn goed bij het ontwerp gebleven. Hij is groen geworden, maar voor de rest eigenlijk hebben ze zich keurig aan de tekening van Peter gehouden. En sindsdien is dit de mascotte van Arsenal. Peter heeft jarenlang tickets gekregen, samen met zijn familie, om naar de wedstrijden te gaan kijken. En een heel fijn verhaal is natuurlijk ook dat de man die in de Gunnersaurus Rex zit, klinkt heel fout, maar er zit in de in. Dat is ook een heel verhaal apart. Jerry Quay. Jerry, vanaf dag 1 speelde hij de Gunnersaurus Rex. Waar Jerry ging in de Gunnersaurus en omgekeerd. En hij moest opdraven bij wedstrijden. Ik kent de mascotte, moet het publiek opjagen. Moet bij kinderen langs gaan. Heel de zwik. Deed dat met veel plezier, heeft dat heel lang gratis gedaan. Tot 2020. Het verdoemde jaar 2020. Ja. En dan hebben ze eigenlijk beslist om Jerry op straat te zetten. Özil, de grote spits, heeft toen gezegd, weet je wat, betaal Jerry alsjeblieft met een stuk van mijn loon. Zo wat wel, heeft dat niet gevoeld, maar het was een sympathieke beer stond. En toen hebben ze Jerry eigenlijk terug aangenomen, gelukkig. Ik denk dat ik bijna, mijn tijd dat hij er bijna op zit, denk ik, ongeveer, dus ik ga een beetje doorscrollen. Wat nog een leuk verhaal is, ik ga even kijken naar dit, is dit. Ik ga voor ik een muziekje laten horen. Sinclair Oil is een oliebedrijf uit Amerika die in de jaren 30 een nieuw concept bedacht en sindsdien staat er een grote lange link op de logo's op hun tankstations. Ja. Nu, Sinclair is eigenlijk de naam van het bedrijf, maar is ook de naam van de familie Sinclair. Uit de jaren 90, Dinosaurs. Jim Henson, de man van de Muppets, heeft deze serie bedacht. Heeft het helaas nooit op televisie weten komen, omdat hij helaas net ervoor is overleden.
Maar ze heten allemaal Sinclair. Het is eigenlijk een beetje een ode aan het oliebedrijf. Net als dit. Sinclair, het logo. De mensen van Pixar hebben daar een ding mee gedaan. Ze hebben Dinoco bedacht. En als je goed naar de films van Toy Story bijvoorbeeld kijkt, of Cars, dan ga je die ook heel vaak terug zien komen. Buzz Lightyear die toevallig even aan het tankstation staat. Of de auto's die rondrijden met het logo van Dinoco. Als laatste wil ik graag nog even afsluiten. Ik weet niet of ik het ga proberen afspelen. Het is eigenlijk een, om maar te zeggen, ook in de muziek heel veel geïnspireerd. Kan je veel over lezen in het boek, maar een van de gekste dingen die ik ben tegengekomen is dit. Want ik wist niet dat Johnny Cash een hele CD heeft gemaakt met kinderliedjes. En al zeker niet dat hij een liedje heeft geschreven over dino's. Ik ga u laten meegenieten, als mij dat lukt, 1975. Het is een heel slecht nummer, maar ook heel tof. Super tof. dit is een deel van de tekst. Hij vraagt zich vooral af, hoe cool zou het niet zijn als we met z'n allen af en toe nog een stickertje kunnen spelen met een dino. Als je zin hebt om meer te lezen, dat heel veel leuke verhalen die ik niet heb kunnen vertellen natuurlijk, staat allemaal in mijn boek. Ik heb begrepen dat het daar, en dat het ook wel mag als je af en toe iets recht staat en even naar daar gaat. Ik ga mijn gemakje daar zetten. Als je graag hebt, lekker iets inschrijven. Ik heb ook gratis boekjes. Van de Japanse sponsor. Dank u wel.
Thank you, Harold, for your wonderful lecture. Sounds like Dinomania will end up on my Christmas tree this year. Talking about gifts, make sure to check out our Dino Shop and Paleo Raffle upstairs for some nice prizes or goodies you can buy for the upcoming holidays. Ah, Christmas. I do love this time of year. As long as my old Uncle George stays off the champagne and doesn't set the Christmas tree on fire like last year. Ah, Uncle George. Always the joker. Always the giddy goat. Want to hear one of his favorite jokes? Do you know why the T-Rex went into therapy? He couldn't get a grip on his issues. Fair to say, the joke was quite lonely. I do apologize for this scruffy-looking man who just appeared here with his wheelbarrow on stage. The homelessness problem in this city is really getting out of hand. It appears this is our next speaker of the evening. My, times have been hard for some. For the next 20 minutes, we shall be addressed by the remains of Mr. Anton Hennemont. You wish. As president of Palaeontologica Belgica, Anton has specialized in the early history of life on our planet, as well as outreach and conservation. As an advocate for citizen science and open science, Anthony will discuss how to become a paleontologist in today's world. As a dear friend of mine, I would personally describe him as a man who has hit rock bottom in more ways than you could possibly imagine. I've won enough of that, mon cher.
My, what an introduction. So, yes, as Wim already mentioned, hello everybody. How are we doing? Okay, till now, so far, everybody enjoying it? All right, super, super. Well, thank you all for joining us here today. I hope you're as excited as I am for the next talk, which will be on how to become a paleontologist. A short talk, I will not stress it too long, because we have other excellent speakers coming up right after this as well. So, yeah, how to become a paleontologist? A paleontologist. So, a person who studies ancient life. Yeah.
So in case you just wanted to do this conference and have no clue what this is about, so yeah, we're going to talk about fossils and studying fossils, etc. Also, fossils in general, so not only dinosaurs. In fact, I will not mention the word dinosaur during this presentation. We'll do a general talk on fossils and paleontology for that module. Okay? So, what will we discuss today? We will discuss briefly what paleontology is about, and we're going to take a rather in-depth look at the science itself. And after that, we can take different journeys on how to become a paleontologist. Okay? Professional paleontologist, being an academic researcher, or a citizen scientist, and last but not least, a paleontology enthusiast. But first of all, let's start out by giving an overview on what paleontology is really like. So, first of all, we should know, to put things very simple, paleontology is in fact the love child, ladies and gentlemen, between two great sciences, being biology, on one hand, and geology, on the other hand. You know, biology, the study of the biosphere, so everything that lives, all the living things that we have on our planet, and geology, the study of the geosphere, so Earth, all the physical processes, etc., etc. Okay, so basically, one really hot summer, biology and geology, they get snuck together, and 9 months later, ladies and gentlemen, they give birth to this exciting new scientific called paleontology, yes, the study of life from the past, yes. By the way, I also heard that geology, and the summer after that, had an affair with a history book, and that was the birth of archaeology, but let's not discuss that, okay? Okay, so basically, yeah, there was a romantic side of it, but we also have a proper definition for you all, okay? And so paleontology is basically, it's a scientific study of life on the during the geological past, that involves the analysis of fossils, and in their sedimentological context, very often. These fossils are preserved, of course, within the geological records, so they come from, they are being assigned to different times, different geological times. And so fossils, ladies and gentlemen, are the main study object in this purpose. And basically, mankind has been fascinating, by fossils for as long as we know. And there is proof of that, because here on this these beautiful pictures you see behind me, this really shows the intrinsic fascination of humans for fossils. We see in the stone tools that have been carved during Paleolithic times, in this hand axe, you know, prehistoric man was a real expert in carving out stones, carving out tools, and here they really took the effort to, you know, check out the fossil, leave it well placed in the middle, and carve the stone tool just around it. They just as easily could have chipped away the fossil shells that were in the middle of it, but no, they decided to keep it. So there must have been an intrinsic fascination for that strange kind of, you know, anomaly within the stone that they must have appreciated in one way or another. The stones that are pictured here were actually dug up in the UK, and they belong to an ancestor class, not the Homo fossilificus, that's a term I imagined, but it's actually from the Homo heidelbergensis. It is a cousin of our own Homo sapiens species that lived around 500,000 to 200,000 years ago. Right, so now this appeal for fossils is something that, you know, humanity on different continents shared with each other. And we can, well, fairly say that it's a universal trend to, you know, have this intrinsic fascination for fossils. And here is a small overview from the Neolithic. So recently they discovered this huge accumulation of ammonites, which are these squid-like animals, and the fossil remains of their shell in Jordan, I believe it was. It's been dated more or less 10,000 years, that this collection, basically, of ammonites or squid-like animals and their remains were gathered in one place in Jordan, which is quite exquisite. You can actually call it the most ancient fossil collection that is known to mankind. And then further on in the historical times, well, they treated fossils a bit like curiosities. This was the birth of what we call in German Wunderkammers, or rarity cabinets, Cabinet de Curiosité en français, where they, you know, there was a lot of folklore involved, you know, the teeth from sharks, modern and fossil teeth, or shark teeth, were they were said to be the devil's thumbs. And the red coral, you know, they made shrines for it. It was a very fascinating thing. They didn't actually know what it was, but they attributed an explanation that was covered in folklore and beliefs, etc., etc. Then more into the 19th century, when, you know, science really started to evolve, they were also aesthetically valued, as we see here in these nice brochures that were made. And today, well, yeah, 21st century, not love to prepare a good bouillabaisse in this kitchen filled with dead fish. Right. Now, we see in paleontology that often there is an unbalanced interest between in invertebrates, and especially dinosaurs, but also mammals, giant mammals like mammoths, like saber-toothed cats, like reptiles and pythons, etc., etc. These are often at the center of all interest in paleontology. And consequently, the vast majority of all interest in these biological groups, makes that other groups are not really studied that well, or that the interest is not shared from the other groups. And yet, as a paleontology, in paleontology, the vertebrate section of everything that lived on Earth is just a very small section. There's much, much, much more. And for example, we haven't discussed, or often we don't discuss, the kingdom of plants. Same goes for microfossils. There's a whole world of microfossils which can be found in small samples, or sampled in very small quantities, and you already have thousands and millions of individual samples, of individual microfossils that are present in a very, very small sample. And what about fungi? You can say, okay, yeah, the interesting kingdom of lichens and molds, etc. Well, they disappear quite quickly, one would think. But actually, in the fossil record, we also have these giant fungi-like structures in the early Devonian, late Silurian, which grew to be as high as trees, smaller than trees, so quite impressive fungi that roamed the earth at a given time. And what about seeds and spores? All our good friends that cause allergic reactions and make us sneeze, aren't they wonderful, ladies and gentlemen? They also surround us, and they actually allow us to retrace or reconstruct rather paleo environments, if it's not too long ago, for the Quaternary, for the last 2.5 million years, we can actually find spores locked into the sediments, and it allows us to reconstruct entire environments, creating all the bushes, all the trees, all the shrubs, everything that forms a decor of other animals that roamed the earth at a given time. Okay, that's also part of paleontology. And of course, we have invertebrates like this lovely trilobites, you see pictured here, a huge, huge, huge group, which is often also underrepresented. And then, of course, all the traces they make, vertebrates, invertebrates. This is also a study that within paleontology is a bit, you know, not as popular as vertebrate paleontology, I should say. Okay? Okay, so now everybody, I think, is more or less up to date on what paleontology is. So now let's take a closer look at the science itself. Let's analyze the science. God, that sounds boring. But don't worry, we'll keep things enjoyable with silly jokes and infographics to keep you entertained. Okay, first of all, I'll be giving an overview of what really constitutes paleontology as a science. And first of all, big fan of everybody, I guess, is first step is fieldwork. Yeah, going out, getting dirty, out in the field, getting your hands wet, getting all soaked up with sediment and really cold and really sweaty, really hot, depends on where you're doing fieldwork at a given time. And, you know, it's not like in the movies, ladies and gentlemen, this is not archaeology. We don't use brushes, we don't use pencils and scrapers, no, we use hammers, chisels, iron rods, bulldozers, pickaxes, you know, all the heavy equipment. So it's nothing for the softies. Okay, so once you actually extracted things from the ground, you actually dug up and you walked your ass off to excavate some stuff, you can finally continue preparating it, because there's a lot of sediment, you know, stuck onto it. So in order to have it three-dimensionally prepared, you need to conserve and prepare everything you found. Okay, which is often a very long and painstaking thing to do. Requires a lot of specialized materials, a lot of investment in a good preparation lab and conservation lab, consequently, which takes a lot of time. And so once that is done, you can actually start thinking about studying the subject at hand. You can actually do really spectacular things on it. You can shoot it with laser beams, you can freeze it in liquid nitrogen, you can burn it up until there's some ash left, and then try to get some data from that. And then don't be alarmed, there's also some non-destructive stuff and analysis that can be performed on it, but you know, they're the less exciting for this audience. And then actually when you get the data out of it, you can actually start to write and start to research and start to publish all the results you have. So actually, yeah, quite a great science. There's a practical side with the fieldwork and the preparation. There's a destroying of things to get data, so really spectacular, and then effectively, well, boring bit, writing, publishing, but you know, some of the slides. Alright, so paleontology as a science itself doesn't really, you know, doesn't live on its own. It also collaborates with many other sciences. Of course, as I said, paleontology itself is the love child between biology and geology, so they are also pictured as the main sciences on top of this slide. So, you know, biology describing the morphologies, the traces of fossilized organisms, and geology placing them in a geological context, so context of layers of sediment of different times, and you know, attributing all the features that we find within the strata. But also chemistry. Lately there is a lot of movement in the geochemical domain, where a lot of analysis are being performed to analyze both the rocks and the surrounding matrix, so the stones in which fossils are kept, or are preserved rather, and you know, these allow us to reconstruct more of the environment. There's also an aspect of physics, and I'm really talking about, you know, when we're talking about the we're talking about physics in vertebrates, then we're thinking about locomotion and reconstruction and anatomies and trying to figure out how animals walked and what the dynamics were, the mass of the muscles, etc., etc. There's also a historical side to it, because in literature, you know, paleontology is very old science and has been practiced for many hundreds of years, and so a lot of data, a lot of observations have already been written down. So in fact, before studying anything, you should in fact, before anything, go out to the library, find everything that has been written on a certain subject, and then try to, you know, compile everything together and see where you can attribute to everything that has been written in the past already. And this is also a major part of the research. And then there's a crossover, of course, between paleontology and archaeology for the really recent stuff, which, you know, is not related to humans or mankind. And then we're talking about zooarchaeology, palynology, anthropology, etc., etc. Okay, so let's start to pick a journey. I described three journeys: a professional researcher, a citizen scientist, or a paleontology enthusiast. And we're gonna check all these three options to see what is, you know, what could be an interesting path for people who are maybe searching to contribute something to paleontological research, shall we? Okay, so first, let's talk about the benefits of being a professional paleontologist. Of course, we all know that, you know, professional paleontologists will, by definition, be very cool, charming, socialite, who effortlessly draws all the attention at a party. But let's look at some other quotes as well. Basically, you're often the first person to describe maybe new species or new taxa, things that are unknown to science in the first place. And this will allow you to uncover parts of evolution, or the evolution of life rather, that are not known to mankind. You can actually teach and try to educate people around you on how past, how animals evolved, how organisms in general evolved from their humble beginnings to the world, the biosphere as we know it today. And actually, in some cases, well, in most cases, you actually get paid to go out on the fields, find new stuff, discover fossils, blast them away, do some analysis on them. Yeah, basically a great field of research. And so, well, it's quite a complicated start, really, because as a professional researcher, well, you know, you need a high school degree, and then the journey really starts. You have to do a bachelor and master thesis, or bachelor and master studies in geology or biology, especially here in Belgium, to become a paleontologist. When you completed your bachelor and master, well, then it's up to the next stage, and you should do, or you can do a PhD, become a doctor in paleontology, so have 3 or 4 years of really hard focusing and studying one particular subject, and then at the end, if you've written a good thesis and published some really impactful research, you can actually become a doctor in paleontology, really raw. And then, well, the rat race begins, because, you know, being a doctor is not easy, and if you want to stay in academia, you should, you know, travel the world in search for job opportunities as a postdoc. This can take quite a long time and can be very stressful for social life, of course. And if you keep it up long enough and you have a good network and a lot of old professors die or something, you can actually take the place of somebody who quit the paleontological research and maybe become a tenure track permanent position professor and have a lab if you have the necessary funding and, you know, basically sit back and enjoy the show, I should say, well, not always, but until the end, until retirement. But, you know, passion is always at the basis of an academic career. It's not an easy career, it's not a lot of money involved, as you might know. Well, a bit more in dinosaurs than trilobite research, I should say. But, you know, it's a difficult career, but not an impossible career. So, that's a good thing. But there's other options to become a paleontologist, or shall I say, to contribute to paleontological research. What is that? That is, well, rather novel concept. It's called citizen science. A person into citizen science in paleontology is called a citizen scientist. A watchman scientist, a citizen scientist, a Bürgerwissenschaftler, a scientific citoyen, or in German, ein Bürgerforscher. That reminds me, there's some good burgers at the exit, so please check out the people from the Wittgenstein. There's some excellent burgers over there. No, a citizen scientist, ladies and gentlemen. This is a person, basically, who doesn't have a degree in biology or geology, but nevertheless contributes to scientific research. And this can be done on many, many levels. So you can have a really novice level of scientific contributions that one can make by erecting a collection, going out, looking for fossils in the field, and identifying them, giving them names, and keeping a scientific, well-organized collection. That's a really beginner stage. But that is already an important part of scientific research, having a good collection and doing things the appropriate scientific way. Then there's some intermediate levels where you can teach soft skills, hard skills, and share your observation with researchers. You can actually contribute to research that is going on, try or ask if you contribute to certain aspects, maybe write 2 or 3 things on how you found it, and you can really grow to expert level citizen scientists. And here in Belgium we have actually quite a number of really impressive citizen scientists who contribute on a daily basis to paleontological research. We have some top-notch experts in fossil whales, for example, in paleobotany, in fossil shark teeth, etc., etc. People who didn't study geology or biology, but nevertheless they produce some high-impact peer-reviewed papers on a steady basis, and they are regarded as international experts in their field of research. So that is really comforting to know that there is also that option to contribute to science as a non-professional researcher. So, as I said, but that also comes with a number of obstacles, okay? So, there's a lot of prejudices surrounding citizen science. There's the bias that, okay, well, their science and the results are often biased. Well, we can't take this person seriously because he doesn't have an academic degree. ivory, etc. There's the ivory tower mentality that we find with everywhere around the world. Well, that's, you know, something we have to fight in the coming years. There's also restricted access, since most of these people are not connected to universities or academic institutions. There's some restricted access if you want to access publications, articles, etc. Lab equipment if you want to do research yourself, it's quite costly. That's also quite an obstacle. There's costly fees if you want to attend conferences, if you want to perform analysis, etc. There's no funding because you're not connected to a research institution. And often there are some journals as well that exclude the contributions and the scientific publications of citizen scientists just based on, you know, the fact of them being a citizen scientist and having the idea that their data or their work is by definition biased. So yeah, these are quite important obstacles to keep in mind going or taking them. And finally, we can also contribute to science by just being a paleontology enthusiast. And how does that work? Well, ladies and gentlemen, actually, we are now living the second paleontological renaissance. It is in full swing, you might not be aware of it, but never in history has there been so much information on paleontology, on social media, in films, movies, theaters, etc., etc. The fascination for paleontology is that the pinnacle of interest around the world, far more than it has ever been in the past. You can attend fossil fairs and fossil shows. There's often really interesting fairs being organized by paleontological associations, which offer you a great day out to start. You can actually learn and see fossils and talk with people at these fairs. They will tell you a lot of things that, you know, you won't have or you won't find in a museum, so really worth the trip just to visit a fossil fair or a fossil show wherever you live. We have some amazing here in Belgium, in the Netherlands as well, so keep an eye out for these very interesting fairs. Or you can actually decide to pick up membership, become a member of an association, and you know, contribute to excursions and see or attend the lectures that they're organizing. So quite a lot of ways to, you know, in a very passive way, also contribute to paleontology, just being enthusiastic about the science. So if you sum this up, you can actually support paleontological research financially by giving a small donation for a research project that is not funded by government, for example. You can, you know, anyone can perform research, so despite race, gender, academic backgrounds, etc. You can attend the opening of exhibitions, new museums. You can attend presentations or lectures at university or associations who organize lectures, etc. It's open to a lot of people, so we all welcome everybody. You can educate people around you. If you already know quite a lot on paleontological topics, you can actually go out and talk to people in your surroundings and educate them. Like, what is the difference between archaeology and paleontology? Please, people, help me, because I've been saying this for over 25 years and there's still people confusing two sciences. And, you know, or you can just carefully consider a purchase. If you're trying to buy a fossil, look into the fossil first and then make the buying of the fossil rational fossil, so something that you thought about. Okay? So, I thank you very much. As president of Paleontologica Belgica, we organized this event also to support our research for the next year. And all donations are welcome at the entrance of the auditorium. We use dinosaurs to support our research for trilobites. So in 2024, we would like to buy an excavator or rent an excavator to dig up some amazing fossils here in Belgium and study them, of course, in an international research project. So if you would like to support us, please, your donations are more than welcome. And I thank you all for your interest, and I hope you have a very pleasant continuation of the evening. Thank you very much.
Yet again for making this marvelous evening a reality. I think this merits another round of applause, don't you think? He's probably hyperventilating backstage. But I'm excited to announce our next speaker for tonight, perhaps the most colourful of them all. I'm talking about Melanie Dury, of course. Often described as the Dutch rock star of paleontology, Melanie is a vertebrate paleontologist, currently employed as a research assistant at Uppsala University in Southern Sweden. A lifelong fascination with extinct fauna and evolution drove her to independently familiarize herself with vertebrate morphology and comparative anatomy, especially since the appearance of her latest book, The Last Lament of the Dinosaurs, loosely translated as The Last Spring of the Dinosaurs, she gained a lot of positive feedback and popularity among the public. Tonight, she will be telling us all about the contents of her book, as well as some personal stories of her career in the field. Give a round of applause for Melanie Dury.
I'm actually still a PhD student. But that is nothing. All right, so my book sadly is in Dutch, so I cannot just yell at everybody to go buy it because I think it's going to be hard to read if you don't speak Dutch. My apologies. My publisher is Dutch. But I will talk to you about my research that actually led me to write the book, which is titled The Mesozoic Terminated Immemorial Spring. In other words, the meteorite that killed the dinosaurs struck in spring. And I'll sort of walk you through how we uncovered this. So, the meteorite we know struck. Bim is going to talk you all the way through that, and I don't want to ruin it too much or take away his moment. But 66 million years ago, a giant meteorite struck the Gulf of Mexico and caused the extinction of the dinosaurs. It had an extinction rate of roughly 76%, and it was a very selective extinction. Because it was a meteorite impact, we can say something like, there was a lost day of the dinosaurs. We cannot say that about any other mass extinction in the history of life on Earth, but we can about the extinction of the dinosaurs, or at least we can sort of point to it. And shortly after that, it wasn't very comfortable on Earth. Again, Bim will go into that, so I don't want to take away on that. But that last day of the dinosaurs. There's a deposit in North Dakota named Tanis. And in Tanis, we have documented the lost day of the dinosaurs. There was a very big, almost like tsunami-type wave caused by the impact, while the impact material still rained down, and it was all deposited there. And as it did that, it actually buried alive some fishes. And I scanned one of these fishes to confirm that these fishes, the googly eyes tell you where the front is, by the way. Yeah, sorry, fish have too many bones. But these fishes died with impact materials in their gills. And to get this confirmed, we scanned the gill region of this paddlefish. This is the gill cover, and then behind it you get the gill arches, and then the gill rakers, and stuck between there are the impact spherules, which are pieces of earth rock from where the meteorite struck. They got ejected into space, solidified in space, and then rained back down on Earth. And they are all hollow. If they had formed on Earth, they wouldn't be hollow. The air would have just escaped at the top. But because they solidified in space, they are all hollow and stuck in the gills. And actually, some of them are even unaltered in the center, which is really cool, but this is a scan. I can't study this other than make it look blue, which I did. So, I excavated some of these fossils from Tanis, some of these fishes, and these fishes are very convenient critters because, unlike dinosaurs, they are ectothermic, which means they don't control their own body temperature, but also they stop eating once a year because there's no food, and they just do nothing. which you can tell in their bones very well, and it looks similar to tree rings. You have a zone of growth, and then you have a zone of it slowing down, it's like autumn, it's getting uncomfortable, and then it's winter, it's like nothing. And then in spring, it starts growing again. And that's very convenient. So here you have a tree for your reference, and here you have, well, this laser is, oh, it's there. Here you have what it looks like in the bone of these fishes. But that's just visual, and to be very honest, it was my first time approaching this and I was a bit skeptical, so I wanted two things. I tend to break fossils and study their chemical composition, so that's what I did. So I drilled the sections out of these bones and I measured if they were eating or not. So this record gives you, this gives you an idea of, well, if fish eat, then the relative presence of carbon-13 will increase. Because carbon-13 is big, is heavy, plants don't like it. So when plants do photosynthesis, or algae do photosynthesis, they don't like carbon-13 because it's not practical for their sugar. So they don't use it. They just put it in their exoskeleton, or they excrete it as, I don't know, carbonaceous ooze. But they don't use it. So anything that eats the plant or eats the algae gets relatively enriched in carbon-13. So at the top of the food chain, it's a lot more than at the bottom. And in the case of these fishes, if they eat, it's there. If they don't, it's not. I'm not going to talk you through this difficult one because these fishes were in similar waters most of their lives. At least the paddlefish is the only one I got to measure. And also, when it comes to looking at the growth of these fishes, it's not really easy to just look at their bones and be like, okay, so light is growth and dark is non-growth. It's a bit more complicated than that. And also, if I would have just posted that, then the reviewers would have definitely given me a hard time. So what we try to do is actually quantify the bone cells. So when do they make them? When do they not make them? It turns out, it's a pretty good pattern here. They make a lot of them in summer, and then none of them in winter. A lot of them in summer, none of them in winter. And then you see this trend. And then when we compare that to the stable isoanalysis, so to the carbon-13, if they're eating or not eating, we see a similar thing. Not eating, eating, not eating. Okay, we have a gap. Eating, not eating, eating, not eating, eating, not eating. And they were just eating and growing again. But they were not at their summer maximum, or at their winter minimum. They were pretty much in the middle. So, spring. On a spring day, 66 million years ago, the Cretaceous came to an end. And then, yeah, so what? Right? No? That was my first thought. It's okay. And spring, what does spring matter? Well, spring actually matters a lot if you consider even in our lives what we do. What does nature do in spring that it doesn't do in, say, autumn? Because, of course, it was autumn in the southern hemisphere. And it's very different. If you have, like, I don't know, tomato plants or strawberry plants in your garden, and they start to flower a bit too early, and then the frost kicks in, and they all just die, you know? But it's been freezing all winter and they were fine. Because it matters when it freezes. And this is what happened. You get this sudden climatic shock from this impact. On the one half of the globe it's in spring, and on the other half of the globe it's in autumn. And what do we see? We actually see that the reaction in nature is very different. So spring is a season of growth. Are out there looking for partners, tending to their offspring, looking for food. Plants are flowering, are at their most vulnerable, whereas in autumn, they're preparing for hibernation, or their plants are shedding their leaves. It's totally different. And then you see that the post-impact recovery, so how long it took to recover, is actually twice as fast in the southern hemisphere. So that might just have to do with when it struck. And I am the champion in fast talks, by the way, so we'll make up with any questions. And buy my book.
that's just splendid. And I'm not only talking about the lecture, of course. I mean, that has... Wow. I'm obsessed. Do you think I could put it off?
Yeah, of course.
Well, we'll see. Well, as the clock has already struck 9 p.m., I believe it is time for our keynote speaker of the evening. He came to us all the way from the U.S. of A. I'm talking about Professor Chris Shelton. A very hearty welcome to you. There he is. Professor Shelton holds a bachelor's degree in geology from Midwestern State University, a master's degree in biology from Midwestern State University, and a doctorate in vertebrate paleontology and paleohistology from the University of Bonn in Germany. Dr. Shelton has been appointed as a geology chair for the Oklahoma Academy of Science. He's also an honorary research associate of the New Jersey State Museum's Natural History Department. Dr. Shelton's keynote talk is entitled, Is the Dinosaur Your Favorite Dinosaur? I, for one, am excited to find out. Please accept this cute little model as a token of my gratitude. Dr. Shelton.
Howdy, y'all. So if you haven't bought your raffle tickets yet, do so. Are we still giving away a date with me? No? People are giving back? All right. Okay. So I came all the way from Oklahoma, from a little town, you probably call it village, Claremore. If you know an actor named Will Rogers, that's who the statue is of right there. He's actually buried there. The county is Rogers County, and of course the school is Rogers State University. Family. So his father was actually a Cherokee senator that helped with the statehood of Oklahoma when they voted it into the Union. So, get to the talk. Is the Dimetrodon your favorite dinosaur? Show of hands. How many people, Dimetrodon's your favorite dinosaur? Somebody may have given away the first talk, it's technically not a dinosaur, so you're wrong. It's not. And the reason it's not is very simple. Basically, before I get to that, it's been perpetuated in movies, and in the toy company, if you buy a bag of dinosaurs, you will throw in some Dimetrodons with it. It's very iconic, you've got the dorsal cell, but it's not a dinosaur, and I was very disappointed to see in the new Jurassic World movie that they have it in the mine shaft, which I don't know where they got the amber from for it, but that just and actually, if you watch Jurassic Park, it wasn't in the movie, but they still put a toy in because of how iconic it is. So, what's a dinosaur? Well, it's already been mentioned before. Specifically, it's an animal with an upright gait, usually walks on land, but had to live within the Mesozoic period. So, what I'm going to be talking about is things that are older than the Mesozoic. So, if you look... Here is about the apex and the appearance of the Dimetrodon as well as other basal synapses. So what you're seeing on this geologic chart, the yellow line, is actually the oxygen content of the atmosphere. And if you notice, coincidentally, it happened to be at its highest peak when these animals show up. Then it drops towards the end of the Permian to the Triassic where you had the KT boundary. The Permian extinction and later the KT boundary, but like Kuhn said in this talk, it was more devastating to the animal life. Now, it's already been mentioned again, too, amniotes, specifically we're talking about birds, mammals, and reptiles, things that actually have the amniotic sac around them. Modern mammals, you see that in the embryo, in chickens, it's in the egg and whatnot. So, concentrating on the amniotes, hopefully I didn't make up some time here, too. You've got different skull types. You've got some combination of one hole, two hole, no hole, sometimes a fused hole together. You get terms like anapsid, diapsid, synapsid, and eurapsid. We're not going to get that detailed. You don't have to worry about what bones are what. We're going to keep it simple and talk mostly about the three main types. Anapsid, synapsid, and diapsid. And I should have put numbers underneath them so you could see basically how many holes are there. But you can see in the anapsid, you've got the eye socket, there's no hole behind it. Then you got the synapse with one hole, and then diapsid in two. I think it's already been mentioned that dinosaurs are basically diapsids. They have two holes. We're going to be concentrating mostly on the synapsids. But anapsids, usually this is what's going to be your turtles. There's now, I think, a consensus where they're trying to put anapsids in with diapsids. But like I said, we're just going to keep it simple and consider them a no-hole behind the eye end. Then the diapsids, again, this is your modern birds, crocodiles, some of your reptiles, marine and flying extinct reptiles as well. But in our group, and I always like to say this when digging in Texas, since I did this for my PhD, one of the highly concentrated areas you can find these in is Oklahoma, Texas. So I'm actually digging up one of probably the oldest ancestors that you have. So you've got the basic synapses, which leads up to the modern mammal line. And there is a human skull here. This is basically our zygomatic arch where the jaw articulates. And then in a synapse, it's just so they perpetuate this one hole all the way from the early or late Carboniferous to the late Paleozoic through the groups, the basal synapses, the therapsids which come up next, but you got to travel to Russia and Africa to see those, some are in Brazil too. You get the specialized cynodontia, which I'll just briefly mention at the end. These show up with dinosaurs, and then you get the modern mammals after the KT extinction. So, when looking at synapse characteristics, there's a couple different things. You can actually go to Wikipedia, and if you Google it, it comes up with the specific characteristics. You have different sized teeth, there's a situation with the jaw, how it articulates, what bones are there, the palate. We already mentioned the temporal openings. Again, it's a synapse, and so we're just dealing with one. Obviously, mammals with mammary glands, skin and fur, the ability to have aerial locomotion, which is relatively new. But what's interesting is if you scan down that page, the very last paragraph, they mention that you can characterize synapses by having a high metabolism using histology and proxy. That's what I'm going to concentrate on because that's actually based on my research. If you go to that page and see what they reference, it's a press release that we put out for a meeting in Las Vegas. I've published papers since then, but they haven't updated the website, and they've left it as so, we're going to be using a few different terms. You've got, I just mentioned synapses. It's been called primitive or basal synapses. More complicated, the non-therapsid synapses. It's also been called primitive mammals, mammal-like reptiles, which I like to use. But colloquially, we'll probably say polygosaur. So, again, I don't have to talk about cladograms. Couldn't get a really good job about that. But this gives you an idea of the overall evolution of the synapses. And this one's flipped from the one you saw earlier. So, the basal primitive synapses from the Carboniferous Paleozoic are at the top. You can see it splits off into six groups. And we'll go into detail on those in a second. We'll break them up by how they eat, by their diet, carnivores versus herbivores. And then as you progress down the clade, you'll see the next group, the therapsids, actually branch off from what are known as the synapsids. This is actually the group that contains the Dimetrodon that we'll be talking about. But I'll talk about the other ones too. Dimetrodon, it's iconic because of the dorsal cell, but there is actually a herbivorous version that also has a dorsal cell. And to me, it's like herbivores are actually more interesting than the carnivores. So here they are broken up. You've got the carnivores at the top, Dimetrodon in the center, the synacodontids, and not all of the synacodontids are going to have a dorsal cell. As you can see down here, the adaphosaurs, these are the herbivores, caseans, adaphosaurs, they also have a dorsal cell. And you would think if two animals have a similar structure that inside the body, it should look relatively the same, but we find that it does not. So there's something there that's actually changing either the physiology or the mechanics of the body, changing the bone tissue. And I'll get into a little bit of detail on this in a few slides, but there's always been a classic debate on what exactly that dorsal cell is. A lot of people think it's like a solar panel. The thinking on these animals is that they were very primitive, very slow, reptilian-like, and if you know a scientist named Robert Walker, he wrote a book called The Dinosaur Heresies, where he was one to perpetuate the warm-bloodedness of dinosaurs, and one of the key pieces of evidence that he talks about is that they didn't drag their tail. You never see a tail drag with dinosaur footprints. You do see that with some large reptiles, lizards, maybe some crocodiles. But that's always been an argument, too, that I've said, if you ever look at the fossil tracks of a Dimetrodon, you do not see tail drag marks. So, obviously, it was quite uplifted. But there's people that still want to call these very primitive. They had to be slow-moving. They had to be ectothermic. But my research shows that they were not. A little bit of background on plesiosaurs. You can divide them up by size, diet, environment. Here, just showing you some basic facts about them. You've got your carnivores mostly here. You've got the Ophiacodon, the Dafosaur, which actually delivers. Then the Synacodon, which is the Metrodon, is, and a small little iguanodon size plesiosaur known as Pyranobin. And unfortunately, I don't have any material on the Eothyrid. It's very rare. There's only some skull material known. But size-wise, it's similar to the Pyranobin, I believe diet-wise, let's see. So if we look at the diet and map it over the cladogram, we can see carnivores, meat-eaters, plant-eaters, Ophiacodon's considered a fish-eater, and then the smaller ones are going to be considered insectivores. Sorry, dry mouth. Now, if you watch Jurassic World, most specifically Jurassic Park 2, you may have seen a character in it named Robert Burke. Well, if you Google or look at Wikipedia on the history of the film, this was actually a favor, I believe, Spielberg did for Jack Horner, who was also advising on the film. And classically, Jack and Bob don't really get along. They wouldn't even attend the same meetings hardly for years because they always argued over specific things like, this one dinosaur might be the juvenile of this one, or there are several species. But if you use bone histology, often you can resolve that. But the real Robert Bakker is actually a really good friend of mine. He actually helped me get some of my jobs that I have and wrote reference letters for him. He wrote the book, like I said, Dinosaur Heresies, and now he's actually been working pretty closely with a local museum in Seymour, Texas, working in the Texas Redwoods. So he has got his fingers in the well. So if you want to study plesiosaurs, there's a few places you can go on the planet, but mostly they are concentrated in Texas and Oklahoma. We also New Mexico, Germany has new species, and I want to say possibly China, but I'm not sure. And we actually got to dig in Texas. This was from my research when I was doing a PhD in Bonn, Germany, and it was actually just by luck. There was a problem with one of the trips we were going to go dig in the water for ichthyosaurs, but something fell through, so they decided to do a trip to Texas, so we got to dig up some stuff for my work. And if you ever went to Texas, you do have to be careful of the plants, the animals there, they can kill you, as other researchers have mentioned back in the past. Plus, you got to watch the weather. And here's the shot of Texas. This is the dig site that we went to. Briar Creek bone bed in the background. It was actually first opened by a researcher named Case in 1915. It's exactly the same spot that we reopened in 2011. And like I said, we were fortunate enough to be there after a tropical storm, so it washed all the sediment off and uncovered a really nice bone bed. And you can see here some of the bones that have been exposed, just basically breaking apart and washing out of the sediment. Femur, tibia. But almost all the little black rock you see are bone fragments and teeth. So, seeing where the bones were coming out basically told us where to dig. So we opened it up, dove in head first, and I think we did two or three excavations there. This was from the first dig that we did. This was our conference table back in Germany. You can see we've got tons of material. Not all of it is related to the plesiosaurs. Some of it is amphibian. Some of it's fish, there's some trace fossils in there as well. I think we also found some plants. So, we actually had to ship some of our plaster blocks back to Berlin for them to be prepared and worked on. And we actually had collaboration with them where they actually kept some of the material that we found for the museum. And some of it we haven't ever seen it yet either, just kind of this. So, we did find some Dimetrodon remains. I think this was from our third dig, or second dig at the site, and I've got the picture sideways here like this, because that's how the dorsal fin is laid out in the rock here. So if you see little circles right there, that's the base of the vertebrae. So they extend from the body that would have been here up to the spine. So these are the spines of the dorsal spine. So that's what you're seeing here. Now, unfortunately, we didn't get to go back to the sites. We weren't allowed to for some reason, some people, the landowners. So we don't know if we were actually digging towards a head or the tail, and we just basically popped out half of the dorsal stone. This is some of the other material that came from the dig. This is one of the pieces from the plastic jacket I mentioned. This is a jaw from what's known as an eriops, basically the T-Rex of frogs from the Permian. I think you actually have a copy of the skeleton in the museum here in Brussels. I'm actually able to go visit it today. You do also have the Metrodon skeleton there too, which almost every museum has one because of how iconic they are. And I got to go to Germany for my PhD, and I got to learn a skill known as histological sampling. And when you approach a curator and you want to cut up their material, they don't like that. So we used to use the term destructive sampling, but to be a little more PC, now we say consumptive sampling. Jack once told us it's basically the equivalent of going to the Louvre and asking if you can cut a little piece of the Mona Lisa off. They don't like that. So if you've got your eye set on a holotype or maybe a very rare specimen, you got to kind of finesse and sweet talk the curator and let you do it. Depends on the institution and the person. Obviously, the worst thing they're going to do is say no. You've got to replan your research. But if they say yes, then yeah, you get to get everything up, which I like to do. And also in Germany, I was able to study some of the class 6 spinachodontid fossils there too. This is Pantelosaurus sexlonicus. It's in the same group as Dimetrodon. It's a spinachodontid as well. This was found in the bottom of the mine shaft, but as you can see on the backs, they don't have a dorsal stone. So not everything in that group has a dorsal stone, only certain Dimetrodons. But why study palaeontology? Well, you can learn a lot about an animal just by cutting it open and looking inside. And I'll have to give you a little bit more background on bone tissue, specifically what you're seeing here in this image. This was photographed with a filter, specifically a lambda filter in polarized light. And at the time, when I was studying this, I didn't know that those colors actually meant something until I taught physics. So if you've had physics, you know about the primary and secondary additive and subtractive colors. If you've ever bought an ink replacement cartridge for your inkjet printer, what are the three colors that it comes in? Yellow, not red and blue, cyan and magenta. I don't know what it is in Dutch. Is that magenta?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, magenta. So that actually means, so if you study physics, that is specific colors that you need to know. You can't just call it blue and yellow. That's not correct. I didn't know that for a long time. So it's very interesting. Oh, back to, so you can tell a lot about how an animal grows. I've been a big proponent of cutting up growth series or ontogeny. You can't just cut one bone, look at it, and assume that's the same thing for the whole animal, the whole group of animals. You've got to look at juveniles to adults, so always cut up ontogenes. You can tell a lot about the phylogenies, how possibly they might be related, how the body works, environments from outside on the body, like if there was a drought, like Melanie said, with seasons, winter versus summer, you get a slowdown in growth. You can obviously read the tissue like you can a cross-section of a tree. And you can also tell if the animal possibly had diseases or not with pathologies. So, like I said with the growth series, you see here there's a juvenile bone, get to the adult, you can see there's an obvious change in the morphology, in the structure. You can take a longitudinal section here, and you can see there's spongy bone, compact bone, spongy bone, and it gets to the compact bone again. You take the cross section, that's what they show you through here, you get more of the cortical tissue the lower you go down the diaphysis. Exactly where this blood vessel is coming in, that's what's known as the nutrient foramen. And we discovered that basically that's to give you your best record of growth. So that's basically where you want to make your section. So bone's very dynamic. It's changing. You've got osteoclast, E mode, you've got osteoblast, P producing bone, one side or the other, it's moving, it's, if you're a living organism, put pressure on it, you're going to have changes in the structure, it's not dead. Going a little bit closer, you can see things like growth marks, you've got the surface of the bone on the left, and inside medullary cavity on the right, which is a cross section. You've got trabecular bone being reorganized and remodeled into secondary trabeculae, you've got vascular canals on the left, and more primary. You get overlap of secondary, you just get tons of structures you can see in your cells, lines of growth, various things. So you can tell them. So if you want to cut these, like I said, you want to go towards the neutral foramen, it just happens to coincide with what's called a minimal diaphysis circumference. So you just measure the bone shaft, see where it's the smallest, usually that corresponds to where the neutral foramen is. Now you can't always do a full cross-section, unfortunately that's the best. That you can see the full growth in the side of the bone. But if you have something like a sauropod where the leg bone is bigger than you are and bigger around, you usually have to take a drill or a core. That's basically what I had to do with some of the material here. I wasn't allowed to do full cross-section, so it's actually a smaller version than what they use on dinosaurs. It's a Dremel tool. This was at the OU Museum in Norman. And I'm not going to get into too much on the pataphonomy, but this is, on the right, a bone of one of the larger herbivores, and it was really interesting when I first drilled it. I pulled the core out, all the bone just fell out, looked like sugar. I thought it was going to have preservation, but I didn't see it until I did a full cross-section, but what kind of process? So a little bit more on different types of bone tissue. This is what we're going to use as a proxy for warm-bloodedness or endothermy in these basal synapses, which they thought was good. You get usually reptilian bone is usually considered like this, lamellar zone. It's very slow growing, there's not a lot of vascularity in it. Woven fiber bone, you can see it's highly more vascularized. The matrix is interwoven, it's kind of chaotic looking. We often see this in juvenile material, regardless of it being either herbivore or carnivore. Then you get variations, thus, of parallel fiber. Fibrolamellar bone, this is one you see a lot in modern mammals. This is what we were actually looking for in my study in Germany. We were trying to pull the fibrolamellar bone back from modern mammals down to the basal synapses. And then emergent bone you often get with older animals where you get a lot of remodeling and overlap of these osteoids. So you might hear me say some of these words. So, getting to specifically the polychosaurs, we'll start first with the group Dimetrodon is, that's what you want to see here. So the dorsal cell, very iconic, and I've got a few little cutouts here of some of the publications that we've done from. This was one of my first papers, actually. And from it, we discovered that actually there was a new tissue there. It looked somewhat like the mammalian bone, but it wasn't quite there. There was a problem with the development of the bone cells, the vascularity we would call the osteons. They just didn't quite seem to layer out like they should, so we actually called it incipient fibrolamellar bone. We also cut up the growth series and looked at it. We validated a smaller taxon, the Metrodon natalis, which at the time used to be the smallest species, and now there's even a smaller one in Germany. We were able to predict the growth trajectories, and we also showed that there was large and small species living together. Sometimes when you're in a dig, and you dig up all the bones, and you look at them, obviously you can lay them out, and you can see there's a size difference. And again, that's one of the assumptions people make, is that they're seeing possibly different species, or it's just a younger version of an older version. So you really got to cut the bones and look at certain structures to really validate that. And this is just, again, some bone tissue images. On the left, you're seeing light through that polarized filter, but it's not lambda, it's just polarized light. On the right is normal light. And what you're seeing on the left are humeri, like in your upper arm, and then femora on the right. The top are juveniles, and the bottom are adults. And you can see there's a difference in vascularity and organization, basically, of the tissue between a young versus an old animal. Oh, and let me point out here, at the top of the sphere, you see where the growth marks start to get close together? And the vascularity drops out. That's what we call an external fibrinal system. It needs to be renamed though because it was named based on another organism, but that often shows that an animal is reaching what we like to call skeletal senescence, or basically it's old. It's come to old age and it's fixed to die. And here we see a close-up of the bone tissue of the incipient fibrillar bone, polarized light, lambda filter, and normal light. And we don't really get really nice primary osteons in this. This is what we're really looking for fibromelar bone, nice primary osteons and a woven bone matrix. But if you look at the close-up of the normal light, these dark spots, those are where bone cells would be. It's just a hole now, because you've got basically two components of bone. You've got a hard part and a soft part. And when the animal dies, you tend to lose the soft parts. But we're starting to find there's a new branch of paleontology known as molecular paleontology, where you can go in and study what you're doing with the isotopes and pull out the chemical information. There's a whole lot of information there that we just didn't really know about. It was ignored in the past. Next group, this is the one that we actually did find the fast-growing mammal-like tissue. This is classically considered a fish eater, a piscivore, because the skull is very compressed laterally, like you see modern fishing animals getting stuff out of the water, pick that real quick. There's still a debate, though, on whether or not this thing was aquatic or semi-aquatic or not. And classically, in evolutionary research, as you saw in the cladogram, the next big group of animals that come off this big synapse is the thrapsids, supposedly branched off from the synacodontids. Well, now we see that this bone tissue is more mammal-like, but so far nobody's done the analysis, and I think possibly the next group of animals popped out of the ophiacodonts, but that's just my personal opinion. Again, you'll see a few quotes from Bob. This was actually a recent one that he just sent me about the findings that we had from the ophiacodont research. And we also were able to cut up a growth series that was actually already published in Harvard. And again, this is one of the things with the curators where they don't like you. You can cut up stuff that might be like a holotype, only known thing, bone remains of that one animal. If something's published or illustrated, they usually don't want that cut up either. But our findings did show, again, the real fibromelar bone that we were looking for. Again, we had determinate growth, an EFS, but we have no idea whether or not the animal was aquatic. But in the cross-section, you're going to see it here in a second, the connection of the muscles and the long bones are some of the longest or most perpetuate pointy ones that you see throughout this whole group. And there's another herbivorous type we'll see in a second that had a similar type of attachment, which would make one to think it was possibly aquatic. But when you start putting animals in the water that people want to believe they're not, they get mad at you. So we'll see that in a second too. But here's that growth series that I got to cut up that was published in the Journal of Herbivore Paleontology. And I kind of got to sneak it in at the end. It was just sort of like, oh, can I have these too? And they let me have everything in the photo. Except that I didn't get to cut up the youngest, I got to cut up everything else, and I actually got the left and the right humerus of this one. There they are. Cut them up, that's where we took the sections, those are the cross sections. So this one, taphonomically, wasn't that great, the tissue was pretty degraded for both the left and the right. And it was actually broken at the mid-shaft, so you don't get a full complete cross section. But if you notice, here, there's a little point coming off. That's a little bone attachment, or sorry, muscle attachment in the humerus. You can see in the adult, obviously much larger. So again, changing growth, changing the scale. Here is the cross-section up close with histology showing, again, the juvenile of the youngest stuff on the left going to the oldest on the right. You can see there is a lot of vascularity here. Starts to drop off. Again, ignore this. And in the adult, it's almost completely gone once you reach this point, and you start to get that external fundamental system showing up, indicating old age. Close-up of the tissue showing the actual real fibromelar bone that we're looking for. Really nice primary osteons showing up in a woven bone matrix. So basically, we confirm my PhD. Here is juvenile material. Some of this stuff was actually dug up in Oklahoma. This is a core that I got to take from a large adult femur. And again, you can see down here as you progress to the top, you start to get a drop off of vascularity, slowing down the growth, If you look at the cross-section of the juvenile, though, you see there's a change right there. Above that, it looks normal. Below that, it looks way different. That's that woven bone that I was telling you about. Now, I caught these amniotes, and it's believed that these animals laid eggs. However, there's a problem with the fossil record is we've never found an egg. So there's an assumption there that people made. So they actually believe this could be what's known as a hatchling line, but we haven't been able to confirm that. And again, just another image, basically the same bone. Showed a difference in the vascularity, a little bit closer to the polarized light. Here's that, quote, hatchling line. Above it, normal, bottom, non-normal. Very typical. So anytime you cut open an animal, when I was cutting open an animal, and you would see tissue like that, you can presume it's an adult. It's not. That was one of the findings from that Synacodontid fossil from Germany that came from the mine. All the ones that we drilled had basically tissue that looked like this. Looked very woven, which to me would indicate a very young animal. Here are some more cross-sections of Oklahoma material I just included because it's Oklahoma. Ophiocadamiformis, Ophiocadamiformis, these were found in, I believe, Beta. But here, there's that nutrient foramen. That's where you really want to cut it in cross-section, get all the growth record. And you can plot a growth curve over it. I superimposed the youngest over the adult. And we concluded that they lived to about 15 years, and you get the EFS showing up around about half midpoint there. And I believe we concluded they lived longer than the Metropolis too. The Richard Spur locality in Oklahoma, this is one of the locations where you can find bones of the Baranopa. This is a little iguanodon sized, or little iguana sized modern, well, iguana is a modern lizard, that fed on insects, but there was a real problem with this material. It's carbonized, it's from what was believed to be an old cave system that had dissolved, and when you wash these bones, they're 256 million years old, they float in water. Not good. They're also full of pyrite too, so sometimes you don't get to see the entire structure. But we found parallel fiber and woven bone, however, that carbonizing, I think it did block some of the signal that we're seeing. Superimposed over to show the growth trajectory as well. So carnivores, not that interesting. I'm more interested in herbivores. So the caseids, we're going to look at the daphosaurids first. And remember, these also have that classic dorsal cell, just like the Dimetrodon. And again, if that was a thermoregulatory organ like a solar panel, you'd think that the bone tissue would be similar. But it's not. And as we can't digest cellulose on our own. There's theories on how herbivory came about, whether coprophagy of the juveniles feeding on feces of the adults, or compensation with feeding on plants ingesting the insects as well, where you get the symbiotic relationship with the microbes. I don't go into too much detail on that. This is just an evolutionary chart showing size evolution of these animals. They tend to follow what's known as Coates' rule. In the late Pennsylvania, when they show up, they tend to be smaller. As they progress towards in the Permian, they get larger. So we'll start with the Dinosaur, and if you notice, the dorsal cell has something extra on it, but the Metrodon doesn't. It's got these little side tubes. And I actually have research that I haven't published yet, but it's been mentioned in a few other papers, that I believe there was a keratin spike that came off the cells. I still need to publish that, but it would make sense for the defense against the Metrodon if someone's trying to feed on it. But there's more work to do. So cross-section of a Dinosaur bones, you can see it's not as vascularized as a Dimetrodon. It's much slower growing. And this is the femur. If you remember on the Ophiacodon, the bone extension, or the muscle extension on the humerus, much bigger on Dinosaurs for some reason. This is the one of the larger species of Dinosaur. It's known as a leucosaur. This is a secondary osteon of a leucosaur that was photographed in lambda filter polarized light. I actually like to call that the eye of Lupe. It's like an eye of a leucosaur. It's close up of the image down here. You've got normal light on the left, polarized on the right, and you can see here those growth marks again. Approaching the top, there's that external fundamental system. This was a bone that was borrowed from Harding. Well, let's get to the interesting stuff. Titanicus, Casey. So you get a lot of these in Oklahoma and Texas. There's a few in Germany. But the biggest one now is, I believe it's called a Leosaurus, is from Sardinia, Italy. And these things reached up to 2 tons. They were the largest terrestrial animal of its time. It was bigger than the Dimetrodon itself. And you might not be able to tell that this is not the mouth. That's the head. The mouth is right there. That's the eye, that's the nose. Little bitty tiny head. Doesn't look right at all. So I was always wondering, how can this thing reach food if it's on the ground? Well, a lot of people call it fossorial, meaning that it dug, burrowed, like habits and stuff too. But to us, it just made sense to actually put it in the water. But again, that's where people get mad at you. But if you take a cross-section, you remember earlier when I talked about drilling, that humerus of that casing? This is the cross-section of that same bone. That part right there is where I took the core. Pull it out, and the bone just fell out like sugar. And I didn't know why until I looked at it in full cross-section. This is almost the same in comparison to a modern dolphin. All the white you see here is bone. The black is open space. Over here, the black is bone. The red, which is filled in with red dirt, was open space. We don't know why. Assumption in the water. Zoom in on the cortex, very thin cortex. I think this image was taken down here. It's almost like hair thin. It's almost not even there. You can barely see it. And the images of the cross sections that you see had to be photographed with the black paper behind them because for some reason the bone is solid white. No matter where you find these in the world, doesn't matter how big or small they are, they're solid white for some reason. And there's some kind of biological signal in there that we haven't figured out yet either. But again, I think possibly they were in the water. So we did a life reconstruction. We did a paper on the evolution of the diaphragm that you see in mammals. But this is a cartoon that Dr. Bacher wrote in response to our paper. He drew it, sent it to me. Some people don't like the idea, but I think he's starting to come around to it. He likes to call them double white pinheads. And one of the things I actually found, which was really cool when I was digging through the collection in Oklahoma, is possible juvenile bones of this animal. It was basically unknown at the time I was doing my work. When I was going through the archives and collection, there was a little bitty box that said, Blicosaur question mark. Well, I pretty much recognized what it was immediately. I was like, well, these are juvenile Titanicus bones. And I asked the curator, I was like, is it okay if I cut these? And he's like, well, there's not very many of them. Yeah, sure. So like I said, some curators, they don't care, some they do. But when you cut them open, remember the red part is open space. The black part is bone. Well, you might think, well, they've been altered or damaged or something, they're fossilizing. But if you compare them to the adult, size-wise, if you were to superimpose this in the center, look at that. See how much red there is right there? That would be right in the center of the graph. They almost were unchanged. There was some reason they were so hollow or so vascularized or what we call osteoporotic-like. For some reason, it just, again, to us, just made sense to stick them in the water. So if you map the bone histology of the plesiosaurs, you can see there's basically a correlation with diet. The carnivorous stuff had high vascularization, possible woven bone, bone, carnivores, machinodon, and dimetrodons would eat. Ophiacodon ate fish, marinopods ate bugs, but then you've got a difference in the bone tissue between your herbivores. So my conclusion basically was it was diet that you're perpetuating into and not physiology. So basic findings of the plesiosaur, the basic synapses, carnivore plesiosaurs grew faster than the herbivores. Herbivores, though, apparently lived much longer and got bigger. And if we go back to the dorsal cell, I don't think it had to do with thermoregulation. Now, it might have a little bit, but it was an influencing factor because you saw how different the bone tissue was. And also, if you just look at the bodies of these two, look at the skull. See how big it is in the Dimetrodon? Small in the Dinosaur. Look at the tail. Small in the Dimetrodon, big on the Dinosaur. Looks like a crocodile and alligator tail. If you're trying to get away from something and you can't run that fast, the easiest way is to jump in the water and swim away. I mean, that's what it looks like it would do. Also, there's like a size comparison of the dorsal cell. It's much bigger in the adapsor versus the body they compare to the metrics. I think it's like a negative. So, enough on basal synapses. Now let's skip to the next group, the thoracic. So again, just to review, we were up here in the synapses, we just talked about all their bone tissue. Now we're going to split off and go to the thoracic. Now we're not talking about all of these. There's already been a lot of work done. If you read Osei Chisami's book, Foreigners and the Mammals, you can get a lot of this information that I mentioned already from the thoracic that we submitted. But we're going to concentrate on a group known as the Dinosaurs. So I had to actually go to Africa to do this. How am I doing on time? So I had to go to Africa, I did a postdoc here. I got to study at the University of Cape Town. It's voted one of the 10 most beautiful cities in the world. You can obviously see why. I actually got to live here for a month on the edge near the stadium, the World Cup Stadium. But it's also known for other things. You get the jackass penguin colonies, the hyrax. I forgot what y'all call it in Dutch, but it's got a different name. It's that rodent that has similar teeth. And this is just a time, geologic time scale showing basically how it's divided by biological groups. We're going to be looking at the Tapetus of Phallus zone here, and they're color coordinated as well down here in the southern part of the country. Before I actually started studying there, I got to go on a field trip, and I actually started doing dinosaurian research before I knew it. I helped find half of a skull that kind of extended the known range of this group of animals. I wasn't a co-author in the paper, but I mentioned in the paper, and the other guy that found it, Mike Day, he's now the curator of the Natural History Museum in London. And if you know anything about Africa, other than humans and mosquitoes, this is the most dangerous animal known to man. You know what that is? Hippo. Actually, I got to teach a course in Africa, and I asked him that, and I didn't know. So I was like, this is your country. You're just... So, if you look at a cladogram, it's basically broken up into big carnivores, big herbivores, and then there's some that are considered omnivorous, both herbivore and carnivore. You get things like giant hippos on steroids, and you get these, some of those pachycephalic animals. They get really thick bone walls. I wasn't able to cut exactly everything I wanted to. I was kind of limited to fragmentary material. And the reason you've got to go to Africa to study African fossils is that they don't allow you to take them out of the country. So there's laws against it. So regardless of what we did, we found a laminar fibrinogen bone. You can see there's the bone tissue here. All the dark spots is actually the vascular component. And it didn't matter what we cut, Antiosaur, Topiocephalus, Oscopia, Struthiocephalus, they all had that same laminar fibrinogen bone. We published 3 papers on it, just came out. And we had a 4th paper, actually. I mentioned pathologies before, bone diseases. Remember that layering of that laminar bone? You can see here, there's actually a change in direction of the bone tissue. This indicates that it was damaged or it had a disease, and then it rehealed. Just because Jurassic World also found a vertebrae on an expedition in Africa, happened to be the second known mosasaur vertebrae from that country. First one came in 1906. And you can find other stuff. There's the other expedition in Megalodon teeth, ammonites, various other stuff. Skip ahead a little bit, running short on time. So then you get to the cynodontia. These are the ones that show up with dinosaurs. This is considered like an inner group of or interbed group of thoracics. They're also fibrinogen bone. You get to modern mammals. This is the museum in Paris. I spent some time there doing research. I'm just showing examples of modern mammals, but you find fibrinogen bone in mammals too. We already knew that. That's why we worked backwards to the basal synapses to try and find it there. There are exceptions to this. There's some small mouse-like, and well, mouse-like, small mice that have reptilian bone, and there's a prehistoric goat known as Maitreyes, which also reflects primitive reptilian bone structure. But here I've mapped, just in red circles, where we found the fibrinogen bone and what we cut up, and of course it goes throughout the play from the basis and absence through to the modern mammals. So I would like to thank the Belgian Palaeontological Society for inviting me here, the entire Stein family for their support and for hosting me, and for Roger State University.
My warmest thank you to you, Dr. Shelton, and thank you again for joining us tonight. Of course, there will be ample opportunity to ask Dr. Shelton all your questions during the Q&A later this evening. It makes me quite philosophical that a passion for dinosaurs can bond so many people across the Atlantic pond and all over the world. Or, as your fellow countryman, Forrest Gump, would put it, fossils are like a box of chocolates. If you eat them too much, they're going to ruin your teeth. There goes my last scrap of dignity. And now, my distinguished guests, I am delighted to announce to you a musical interlude performed by guest musicians of the Interbig Harmony Orchestra in collaboration with the famous VUB Orchestra and the Music Chapel of the Royal Military School of Brussels. They will perform for you tonight a few musical works most recognizable for many of us. Of course, this will take some time to set up, so now would be the ideal moment to get a refreshing drink or a snack. The moment they're set up, we'll be right back. Thank you. please welcome conductor Walter von Isterdal and his Harmony Orchestra. The floor is yours, Maestro. Campus. Wonderful. Thank you so much. It just gave me goosebumps. We are very grateful to all the members of the marvelous Harmony Orchestra who played for us tonight. Another round of applause, I would say.
Of course, the
fact, we're also much more on a longer timescale. We want to better understand it. And for that, I look specifically at two locations. So we have the Chicxulub crater itself in Mexico, and the location Melanie also mentioned already, is called Dinos in North Dakota. So if you basically plot these two sites also on this stratigraphic overview, basically this is what we can do now, because we have found the chemical evidence of the asteroid and all the specific locations around the globe. And actually, the data from within the crater, we drilled within the peaking area of the Chicxulub crater itself. We got a nice type of material out of that, and actually Stephen Coderas, who's still over there, published a paper on the radium anomaly in the crater, because that was very important to basically link the crater itself in Mexico with the actual mass extinction. And then we also have the location of Dinos over here, and as you can see, this is much more expanded, so it's a way thicker. All of its deposits that are actually at the same distance from the crater. So that means that we can get way more information out of it, way more, let's say, a time resolution out of that. So here I have an overview of the different kind of the time and the time intervals, the ejecta snapshots that you could extract from this type of analysis. So basically, if you look at the yellow area, that is approximately a correlation of the, let's say, the first half an hour after the impact, we can see that specific type of ejecta has been found around the globe, and especially around Dinos. We have 1.5 meter of deposit more or less there, and most of it is these servals that were actually found in the gills of the fishes that Melanie was investigating. And then, and that is what this talk is focusing on, is the green area, which is basically the approximately 20 years after. So we're really talking about this fine atmospheric dust that was settling out of the crater and was deposited all around the globe, and we can trace that back. But the nice thing about Dinos is that we can actually really extract and isolate this type of information. So we could really focus only on the top part of these ejectors with really fine-grained material, which we in the end used in our paleoclimate models to extrapolate our data from a specific location towards the globe, because we wanted to know what caused the mass extinction of the dinosaurs, and for that we have to use these atmospheric models. Here is an overview, a drone image I took from the Dinos location. As you can see, it's not that big. And I want to focus on this specific area over there, because here we have the bedrock, basically how the river landscape of the Hell Creek formation looked like. And then on top we have this dark layer, that is where Melanie and others found these fossils of these fishes, and also other dinosaurs and so on. And I want to focus on this topmost part. It's called also Jan's Butte after Jan Smit. Very small bump over there, but actually very important, because this is the final atmospheric fallout of the dust preserved on top of this expanded interval. And basically we have here the iridium-rich Cape Boundary claystone. So that is where we found actually the signature of the asteroid still preserved. And we analyzed this specific layer for the grain size distribution. And why the grain size distribution? Because we need the information from these particles to use in our climate model to see how long this dust would actually stay in the atmosphere and so on. So here I've been doing this type of analysis in Amsterdam, and we got this very fine unimodal single peak in the grain size distribution, very fine, so clay particles. And the take-home message here is that basically all the other type of particles that have been used in previous models to reconstruct the impact on life and climate after the event have all used different types of
grain sizes, either very fine grained or very coarse grained. And we now found kind of this sweet spot, and that was really important. Because basically, this orange curve over here shows how long these dust particles stayed in the atmosphere. On the vertical axis, you have the mass of, the, of this dust plume right after impact, and here the timing. Basically, it took well, approximately 50 years before most of the dust, which was mostly pulverized granite rock, was actually rained down. Well, all of these other models actually showed that they rained down, let's say, within days or months after the impact. And that's where the work from my colleague Jan Sayel comes in, who's also still in the room over there, and his colleagues at the Road Observatory in Belgium. So they are using these climate models. And here's a representation of this using these different types of grids and integrated general circulation model kind of. And what Jem did, he combined different type of emissions right after the impact. So basically, in this story, we are mostly focusing on the dust. We also had material like the soot from wildfires caused by the initial thermal bubbles after the impact and incoming ejecta. And also the emissions of sulfur, basically, sulfur gases and sulfur aerosols. So all of these three components, they most likely contributed somehow to these, to basically the atmospheric perturbations after the impact. But we wanted to know how much. And the dust was important because, as you can see in this animation, hopefully, yes, that basically the darker the color, the more mass of the dust cube is present. And basically, within a couple of days after the impact, Jan was able to model that the entire globe, the atmosphere of the globe, was engulfed by this dust plume. So you can imagine it had a huge impact. And this was really different compared to some of the previous models that used different type of particle information. So you might wonder then, okay, what are the effects then actually on climate and life after the impact? Well, it's shown here. It's a bit of a complicated figure, but I will guide you through. So basically, here on the vertical axis, you have different time snapshots right after the impact, and on the horizontal axis, in a way, we have the different scenarios. So either modeling only the dust, modeling only the sulfur or the soot, and a combined scenario, which was also something new. And what is plotted here is the global photosynthetic active radiation. And that means basically the amount of sunlight that reaches our planet and that could still be used by organisms for their photosynthesis. So think about plants on land, but also plankton in the ocean. And basically, the greener it is, the better it is for life. So what you can find, and especially this dust simulation over here, we still see 2 years after the impact that there was almost no photosynthetic activity on Earth. And this was really something new, because now, for the first time, we were able to put some numbers behind it. How long did this nuclear impact winter actually took? Well, we now have a much better understanding on that. And also, basically, if you look at these other emissions, so sulfur and soot played a role, but most likely the dust was more dominant. Also, if you then all combine it in this combined scenario. So this was something really new, and yeah, we still would like to continue working on this and fine-tuning this. And then another aspect is the temperature. Of course, the darkness was crucial. Also, the temperature was really plummeting. As you can see over here, we have a very happy, warm Cretaceous world. But then, approximately half a year after the impact, we really see an intense cooling, especially on land, with temperatures dropping almost 25 degrees there. And this also took this state for a very long time, let's say approximately 15 years or so. So that also was one of these effects of the dust plume. And of course, this had a huge effect on life, on on Earth as well, and that is something which is not solved yet. It's just the beginning, I would say. So hopefully in the future we can really fine-tune this and find more locations like Dinos to find actually the real fossil evidence to see what really happened in these first moments also after the impact. Because of course we have this poor Dakota raptor, the last of his kind, who was struggling to find some food in, let's say, the lab in the months after the impact. So he was still able to probably survive his first moments, but then in the end it got too dark and too cold to survive. And on that positive note, I would like to thank you all.
If you would want to know what exactly happens when a meteor the size of Mount Everest crashes into the Earth, Pip can tell you every aspect and effect of such an event in high detail. Thank you again, Tim. Bless you. Now, over to the Q&A with the audience. In order to let things like these run smoothly, we will throw this cube, which also happens to be a microphone, by the way.
Test, is it on? Is it on? Jurassic Park, you think?
Well, of course, now, if you have a question, raise your hand. I will throw the cube to you. Of course, mention the person who you would like to ask the question to, and throw it back to me. I will do my very best to catch it, although I cannot make any promises. Perhaps I can be a bit cheeky tonight and ask the first question myself to Melody. Melody, well, could you tell us and the audience somewhat more on the whole situation of poor research practice by your colleagues prior to your article? And how do you look back on it?
Oh dear.
Subtle, okay. Could you be a little bit more specific on what you want me to say?
I think Anthony might clarify the situation a bit.
It's a very broad question.
It's a very broad question indeed. I think it might be good for the audience to situate what the problem has been with publicating data and then getting bypassed, and then how does that make you feel? That is something to share.
Well, I mean, as an experience for a PhD, I would not recommend it.
No, I can imagine, yeah.
I'm sure there's people in the audience who have no idea what this is about. There was a paper published in 2021 that seems to contain mishandled data. And reported this to the university, and we reported this to the journal, and I would say that I'm not exactly satisfied with how they're handling it. And then when their panel had concluded in the investigation that there was indeed mishandled data and this was misconduct, the report stated that they would contact the journal. And then an article appears that says, oh, they can redo the analyses. That was not what the panel recommended. Around the time, I also found image manipulation that I don't think is correct. And I decided to send it to them, even though their panel had concluded the investigation. I told them, listen, these image, I'm sure that there's something wrong here. Please have a look. This looks manipulated. And they said, well, we're done, and you can't share it.
If I may interrupt, this is working so hard.
If I may interrupt, because some people don't actually have any clue what's going on. Melanie had published a paper on the boreal spring, basically that the Mesozoic ended then. But one of the original co-authors actually scooped the paper 1 month, 2 months before, and the data looked very suspicious. And it was definitely not the kind of data that you would expect in a outstanding scientific journal. I mean, scientific practices were doubtful at best. And this is where a whole investigation started, and the results have now this week been published, and I think many people are convinced that it's just the university covering their asses, if I may be so frank. You just need to be more open and public. And this is just the University of Manchester covering their asses, covering the scientists involved, and I think it's just a good practice. In general, if I just... I know this is being live streamed, so I'm probably going to be taken for my words. But this is what is wrong in science in general. It's not just paleontology, it's everywhere in science. And it's toxic behavior like that. All for what I think was paying attention. So, just so the audience here also is up to date on that.
Right, well, that gives us food for thought. And now over to the audience. Is there anyone who would like to ask a question to our panel? Please raise your hand if you. Oh,
something fun.
Give them a chance, please.
Okay, let's make this interesting. The first person to ask a question, an interesting question, gets one of these nice T-Rex teddy bears that we put up. Ah! So now they come out of their caves! Alright, make me somebody.
I think the gentleman in the back over there was first, so... Never mind, I'm going to suck so hard.
Is the question has to be interesting.
This is a question I think most suited for Koen, but I think a bit general. Of course, we all know the story of Jurassic Park, the idea, let's bring back dinosaurs into current... It's real! And basically, you know, you have all the, of course, all the ethical considerations, because even if there would be the technology to do it, still there would be ethical considerations to, of course, not do that, just the practical aspects as well. But just let's suppose there's a country where they would just be like, well, screw all these rules, and let's say in a couple of centuries there might be technology to actually do this. How would you think something like that would turn out? That you would have a lot of dinosaurs, what could go wrong, what would happen? Would it be a danger for the planet, or not at all? Or would other countries block that, or just in general?
That's a whole lot of questions. but I guess they're interesting, so I think you are impressed. The technology to, I mean, how could it serve us? In terms of... study of biology, evolution. I mean, given that we have DNA, original, authentic, unaltered DNA of a Mesozoic dinosaur, and bringing him back to life, it would answer a lot of scientific questions if you could actually go through that. But I think you need to answer those. It's a bit of a feedback loop. Paradox, because you probably need to answer a bunch of those questions before you can raise the animal back from the dead, because you need to know about its physiology in order to understand its physiology. So it's a bit of a paradoxical thought.
And you need to not get eaten while you do this.
Yes. I think why we should not do it, there's about six movies made about that.
Yes.
So, yeah. Ethical questions, I'm pretty sure there's countries already working on this. I mean, there's it's probably impossible to get DNA from a dinosaur bone. I mean, Chris has shown us a lot of pictures of sections through bone, and if you zoom in on the details of the bone structures, you can actually see the blood vessels and also the little spaces, little holes where once bone cells used to be. And in some cases, those bone cells are still in there. People have been able to dissolve bone in weak acids and extract those fossilized cells, basically. It's a very complex mechanism of fossilization, but it works. And they have used what we today use in is though chemical staining methods, for example, to show a particular tissue's nature, what kind of cells are there. We can use that on those fossil cells, and people have shown DNA and proteins being preserved. Unfortunately, that DNA is so fragmentary, it's like trying to write a novel based on a few words. So the gaps are actually so much bigger than the actual DNA that's there. It's impossible to do.
So you don't think even in like a couple of centuries with like, I think, AI taking extreme leaps forwards, you still think that would be an impossible challenge?
I'm pretty convinced.
Well, at least not in our lifetime. I would never say that, but not in our.
Because we do have the technology today to cut and paste pieces of DNA in those holes, from taking it from other animals. Perhaps use some crocodile DNA, you know?
Yeah.
Because they're close to birds, and mix birds in there as well, who knows? Maybe even take a bird, people have actually used that idea. And Jack Barnum has this chicken source project where he wants to interrupt certain developmental processes in the chicken in order to have expressed dinosaur characters. I mean, we are already touching on these subjects today, but to really reconstruct a prehistoric dinosaur from DNA, ancient DNA, I think it's a no-go.
And don't forget how closely related we are to everything else that is alive. Everything on this Earth that lives and breathes shares roughly 60% of DNA with you.
Mm.
You share 89% of your DNA with the chimpanzee.
I think 50 with a banana.
Yeah. it's 35% with the greater prices.
We're all carbonates. I'm going to Google it now.
I think the general conclusion is embrace your inner dinosaur. Settle on that? Okay. Was that a good question? Did you deserve the T-Rex?
Yeah.
Okay. So next one, next question.
I would say keep the cube and throw it to next person in the audience who has a question. I saw a raised hand over there.
Really?
Try your best athletic skills.
Our insurance doesn't cover that, unfortunately.
Okay.
I was watching Life on Our Planet, and my brother walked by and asked me, do dinosaurs really have those colors and stripe patterns and such? And I honestly didn't know. So my question is to everyone, or whoever can answer the question, is it always artistic impression, or can we actually determine color and even stripe patterns or other kinds of patterns on dinosaur skin?
I guess that's a really good question. It's hard. Dinosaur color. It's amazing. Use your imagination. I'd say the more color, the better. Look at modern day animals. You see them in a wide variety of colors, depending on the environment they live or the life strategies they approach. Even within the same species, birds. Look at just a common duck. The male's bright colors, green, flashy. And females, they have to sit on a nest, and they have to be, well, protected, camouflaged. So I think it's pretty, and bigger animals as well. When you get a zebra, if you find the bones of a zebra, you wouldn't have no idea that it had this striped color pattern.
Well,
but
we sometimes find the skin, or they can have pigmentation.
Absolutely. So we do have a couple of examples, very rare, of where. The skin and the feathers, and you see shades. You don't know what color they were, but you see shades, like dark. And I think it's Simosauropteryx is an example of them that's already I think published 20 years ago. But they show nice bands of darker, brighter colors, more like a tiger pattern. And melanosomes.
They were also pink.
Yeah.
No, I don't think so. So I'll just answer that even though nobody asked. I don't think they were pink. I don't think they were pink for the simple reason that if you look at modern animals today, and in particular birds, and if you look at the animals that are pink or pinkish, then they tend to have that from the food chain. It's not a structural pigment. So.
Inside pterosaurs.
If they eat the shrimp, they could be pink. Eat the shrimp.
Like flamingos.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I didn't eat all the shrimp.
I haven't
tried the pink yet.
Keep on your bouncing. But aren't flamingos actually birds? Aren't flamingos actually dinosaurs?
Yeah, so there are pink dinosaurs.
Good. That concludes this question. Who's next? I'm sure I saw another raised hand, but that's not all. Go ahead, sir.
I have a question for Professor Shelton. Well, actually, two questions. First of all, you mentioned that you don't think the sail of the Dimetrodon was used for thermoregulation. And you mentioned for the other one, I forgot the name of the other species with the spikes, that it might serve as a defensive purpose. So what do you think is the actual purpose of the sail itself? Because in the Dimetrodon there's no spikes and it wouldn't have to defend itself as much. And my second question is the large, very big animal with the tiny head that you showed. You mentioned it might have been aquatic. Do you have, besides what you already said, do you think there's other pieces of evidence? Maybe you showed that he had a very large tail, and I can imagine something similar is used as evidence in Spinosaurus, where they say the enlarged spines of the caudal are maybe evidence for aquatic lifestyle. So are there any other traits as well that might point to an aquatic lifestyle in that animal?
Well, the Dimetrodon tail usually comes down to sexual dimorphism or sexual selection, like in deer, you've got the antlers, it's visible. There's been some research done where, again, this goes back to the shooting down the cold-blooded theory. They found the sclerotic ring in some of the Dimetrodons, saying that they can see at night, have night vision. So somehow they've got to recognize each other's cells and colors that way. Oh, and somebody mentioned about color reconstruction. Look at the Dimetrodons. There's some really good artistic interpretations. I think people caught or something. There's like just these elaborate like watercolor. But yeah, I think it was more protection from the Edaphosaur, probably sexual selection for the Dimetrodon. But as far as the Tylorhynchus and the cases go for more aquatic evidence, there was a second paper put out on a French case, and they've reconstructed it almost the same way. It's not necessarily a big active swimmer, more of like, think of like a manatee, sort of like floating there, eating. It's buoyant in the water, it's protected out there. There is a problem, I think, with the sedimentology, but also some of the bones are, well, we thought they might have been deformed from the fossilization process, but most of the limb bones are flat and paddle-like. Like you can see in these animals.
It's a bit counterintuitive because manatee is very dense bones.
That's a dry animal.
Yeah, but the porosity that you would see in modern aquatic animals, it's in dolphins who are even more deprived of manatees.
Right, that is one of the problems we ran into, but again, that's the this would be maybe the first reintroduction back to the water. Obviously, they come in on and off.
Or alternatively, you need to cut up more bones, more different bones.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, okay. I agree.
The curator will be happy to see.
Yes. I'm always advocating cut up everything.
Good. Was that a satisfying response to your question?
Yes, thank you.
All right. Anyone else?
Geological question.
Just behind you. Yes.
Thank you. So I'm very intrigued by the idea that after a mass extinction, there is space for certain species to take the stage and evolve. Like, for example, the crocodiles, I think it was. So imagine a meteorite hit the Earth right now. Do you have any idea which species would take our place?
I wouldn't necessarily go for species, but who do you want to answer the question? I think you mean groups.
This is kind of a
I think bacteria and viruses, can we all agree that microbes, bacteria, viruses, they've been there from the start. They will be the last ones to inherit this planet, so I think we should establish this as an
age of insects is coming.
But I think he's picturing a vertebrate.
Yeah.
He just wants to know which vertebrate, right?
Yeah.
Okay, turtles.
If there is one lesson to learn from this meteorite impact, that ended the interpretations, is that I think the kind of three regions of three aspects animal life needed to survive. On one hand, it was better to be small because there was not much food around right after the impact. So everything, let's say, bigger than a dog was not able to pull through. And then also, if you were able to actually shelter, that would definitely help. So try to burrow as a human being, try to burrow, try to be small. And then the last part, don't be a picky eater. That's also very important. Try to just eat whatever gets on your plate. Your parents would also be happy with that. So,
you might eat
so
your
try to be a very generalistic person, and then you might survive the next mass extinction.
But if you look at animals that have been thriving for a very, very long time and that have not necessarily been knocked out by the last extinction, turtles, for instance, are a group to consider. Crocodilians as well survived the extinction.
They
were bigger than the dark. The sharks have been around.
Sharks, they got it. They got it.
Yeah, they might just go on land.
Land sharks.
There's some very interesting speculative. Speculative evolution is a sort of a geeky branch of science, I guess, where people speculate about exactly these questions. And there's a lot of images on cephalopods, squid, and others becoming giant elephant-sized land animals walking on the.
I will.
But maybe I will scare my parents.
Well, I wouldn't mind a squid coming on land as long as it walks on my plate. That's a fun of one in common. Anyone else? We raise hands.
Hi. So I've got several questions that are going to come from other ones that have been asked. So there was a question about if we know if dinosaurs are colored or not, but do we even know if they saw color? Because we have no speculation about that. I mean, the scientific research on vision is like very subjective. So do we have an idea if dinosaurs could see color based on their morphology?
Modern day dinosaurs see color very well. When you look at the plumage, it's there, so they have perception of it.
Do crocodiles see color?
I don't know. I really don't know.
If crocodiles also see color, then you can sort of almost anticipate that at least some dinosaurs would see color, but...
I'm 100% sure there's literature on this, but I'd have to look it up.
From an evolutionary perspective, the eye and the ability to see colors is something that is so individually developed for each species, almost on a species level, depending on the needs for survival, and you know, it's so variable. And it's so difficult to retrace once we go back into the fossil record to really know what could have been the benefits. There's some assumptions for some trilobites to use stereo vision even, or have shades to over their composed eyes to see better and to actively predate. Others look blind, so even in bigger classes you have these really individual adaptations to what is the site, so it's really difficult to reconstruct just based on what we know from the fossil record. There's no factual proof, there's only assumptions, rational assumptions that we can make, but factual proof is really hard in this regard, I think.
It's really hard to find dinosaur animals.
I can imagine. Anyone else?
Please do continue. I'm a pathologist, so I was actually curious on how you process the fossilized bone to see the histological sections. Because we use the gasification for histological specimens, does it work the same way?
You mean how do you make thin sections?
Yeah.
Diamond saw.
Like a rock. Normally you want to embed it to kind of resin so it doesn't shatter first. And yeah. Then you cut it and then you have to polish it down. So depending on what you want to see, if you want to thin a section or just have a polished section, so you want to just depending on what you want to see.
We basically use a technique called petrographic insectioning.
It's what we use on rocks too.
Yeah. So you glue it to a piece of glass, and then you mount it on a precision saw, and it cuts it down to maybe 200 micron thickness.
Yeah.
And then you have to polish it down by hand to
maybe
get to 50
or 30 micron.
So there's no staining or coloration.
No.
The repolarization microscope is on
you.
Then you have like the contrast of the filters from the polarization microscope.
And you gotta use really all the filters to see different things.
Thank you.
Alright, well, if I might be a bit frank, I also might have a question for Harold, and that might be a bit of a philosophical question. One might say, what do you think lies at the basis of our passion for dinosaurs?
Oh, wow. It's a question I get a lot, actually, and I'm not sure about it. I think we're passionate about these animals because we didn't know them, but we think we do because of these guys. They work. What they're doing, they're making us see them again, and we can how do you say it? It's like dragons, but they're real. You see. Like,
I think it's actually where dragons come from.
Yeah. There are many tales from Middle Ages. People think or know, like, dragons, okay, they found bones on the ground, they didn't know what it was. Seems rather big, so we don't know how to explain it with science, so we tell stories. That's where dragon stories come from. But dinosaurs are real. They were real. And I think that's one of the things. They're colorful. They could be colorful. That's why kids love them, I think. Yeah, it's a strange, yeah, they're frightful at the same time. So it's strange, it's a contrast all the time. Like, you don't want to walk around with them, but you do. It's like, it's crazy. It's, I think the answer lies somewhere there.
I think it also, it's not a dinosaur, but for instance, Mosasaurus is it's a marine lizard from around the same time as the dinosaurs. And Mosasaurus was discovered actually around like 1790. Yeah, thank you. Million years. So the thing is that when Cuvier got to describe it, he was actually the first to say out loud, wait a minute, we don't see this is extinct. So the whole definition of animals actually going extinct was brought up by these giant lizards, well, Mosasaurus first, but so the realization that these animals were here and are no longer here occurred simultaneously, which meant that as soon as people were studying them, they were wondering, what if they were extinct? And that just inspired us and allowed us to imagine what it would be like.
Imagination.
Absolutely.
If I can add something to that, it's interesting if you're doing historical research to look into the tales of the Native Americans who were roaming around the Midwest and actually saw a lot of these giant fossils being semi-unearthed. And they incorporated these huge bones and these huge skeletons into their belief system, into the tales that they tell generation upon generation. That degree even, that it became something holy and something, forced to be reckoned with. And then when really there was a great scientific interest, all the bones were dug up and then displayed in museums without even considering Native Americans and the stories that were attached to these seen as semi-eroded or semi-exposed skeletons. So it's really interesting to look into that as well. If you're
then Brontosaurus is the exception.
Okay.
Because Brontosaurus was named after the Native American word for thunder.
Good. All right, guys, we are running a bit of time. We have time for one more question from the public. I see a raised hand over there. It's quite a long shot. I think you'll manage.
Three down.
Only one concussion.
Were you on a fight? No, I went to this science lecture.
Okay, it works. So with the entire debate about the Spinosaurus and many, many redesigns and redesigns about how it looks and how it Do you see a future with more united fronts for the design of the Spinosaurus, or is it always going to be questioning if it was entirely aquatic or if it was semi-aquatic or not?
We just need to dig up more dinosaurs.
The holotype pretty much got bombed.
Yeah, the holotype was bombed during the World War.
So we lost all of the original material that it was described on, and everyone's comparing new material to drawings. So then you get into the argument that someone looks at that and is like, yeah, but that looks different. Yeah, no, it looks the same. No, it looks different. But you can never put them next to the original bone, so it's...
And the current reconstructions are based on, I think, three different individuals of three different sizes, so...
It's like female, old, and crippled.
Yeah, were they the same age, were they... So, we just need to dig up more dinosaurs.
Okay,
thank
you. Fund us.
What a good idea. Anyone else? Yes.
This is... I'm not really into biology or geology. I'm more of a psychology student, so I have more a question about the behavior. Like, in the movies of Jurassic Park, we see a lot of behavior of, like, a velociraptor. So my question is, how do you actually search and research about the behavior of dinosaurs when we don't actually can do, like, experiments, like, in a laboratory to see how they do? So in Jurassic Park, we see the velociraptor moving backs like wolves, but maybe they were just, like, I don't know, sheep. So how do you research...
Sheep has been heard before.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't know other species who, like, more... carnivore or... wolves. Like, wolves are more like moving in a pack like they show velociraptors. How do you research their behavior?
So, behavior is something that's really hard to study from bones, but it is something that you can interpret from trace fossils. So, for every skeleton, you've got, like, thousands of poops and footprints and sometimes tracks where they follow other animals. So, that is your... If you find something like that, that gives you an indication of they moved in packs or they didn't. But quite often, we don't have enough of that, and it's just interpretation. Especially by Spielberg.
I suggest you look at paleopsychology. That's a thing.
Oh my god.
That's probably really, really soft science.
Thank you, Eric. Learned something new tonight. Is there maybe one final question from the audience? Yes, Lady White.
I really want to be a paleontologist when I'm older. But is it possible to get a job in paleontology without doing a doctorate?
Well, you could be a fossil preparator, which could be a full-time position, but I think those are more likely to obtain in the US than in Europe. There's plenty of jobs as a paleontologist that do not require a doctorate, but you're looking for the more fun types of jobs, and there tend to be an excess in people who want the jobs, not necessarily in the jobs. There's never a shortage of people who want to be a paleontologist. And that is just always something that you need to keep in the back of your head when you strive to be a paleontologist. You're looking for the fun job. I'm looking for the fun job. He's looking for the fun job. He's looking for the fun job. He's looking for the fun job. And we are all competing. We love each other, but we are all competing, and it's nasty out there. So yes, it is possible. But it's not easy.
If I can pick up on that. It depends. What are you looking for? I'm going to shoot a question back. You're interested in a job in paleontology without doing a doctorate? So what, you want to contribute to the science? Or you want to do scientific research? You want to do scientific research or something else? The field work, the preparation, conservation? What is that? What is it that would interest you?
I'm not sure about what I want to write exactly.
So, well, even without a doctorate, there's still means of you contributing to research. I mean, you can, as I explained in my talk, you can be a citizen scientist and really specialize in a certain quarry with a lot of interesting deposits. You can pick up a certain clade of fossils that you really like and want to dig into on an evolutionary level. Or, you know, there's plenty of things to specialize in. There's so much literature around, there's so many books that have been written, research that is coming out. Like I said, we're at the pinnacle of the second paleontological revolution right now. So there's so much information available that you can go out, be an autodidact, study everything yourself, and actually make contributions by visiting collections in natural history museums all around the world. They would be happy to show you what they have. And if you say, okay, well, I might be interested in doing some small research on this or this aspect, they will happily welcome you, even without having a doctorate. So it all depends on the amount of time and passion you are willing to invest into it. If you're looking for a seriously paid job, you can go into conservation, you can go into preparation. There's a lot of commercial enterprises as well doing commercial preparations of skeletons, for example. So there are means, but you got to specialize. Conservation, preparation, research, whatever you do, you got to specialize. If you want to do it professionally, you got to go for it, because there's a whole lot of people willing to get these fun jobs, like Melanie mentioned. If you want to go into research, go out. The field is open. There's plenty of associations who will help you finding what really makes your heart beat in terms of research, and just go for it. We're always open to help anyone out who is willing to do it.
If you want to do a professional career in paleontology, I really recommend going abroad. I really recommend it.
Don't go to the Netherlands.
Yeah, I mean abroad, I mean preferably United States or Canada. Those are, if you really want to gain in specifically dinosaurs, because presumably this, or I don't know, maybe vertebrates in general, it's a very nice place to be, and there's many more opportunities. It also enriches your the fact that you're from Europe, you're going over there, you build a network of people. And this is very crucial, is to build a network. Because I met Chris when I was a PhD student in Bonn. We did our PhD together in Bonn, and I have to think, more than 10 years later, he's back here giving a talk on what he did back then. So, it's kind of a, you know, go around and explore. That's all I can recommend.
And just start on a Sunday, go to the beach, look for some fossils. That's just step one. You're gonna find something, you don't know what it is, you're gonna ask, you're gonna pick it up. That's how you get caught with the bug.
Well, I would suggest before you jump the pond and you wanna get your feet wet, just go to your local museum, tell them you wanna volunteer in the department. You can start networking with local researchers there, kind of get a feel for maybe what you wanna do, and then start from there. Because then they'll have connections too, and if they see you have an actual interest in it and are dedicated, they will help you grow.
And then there are actually many different organizations and associations that are not only for academics, but these are also really for students and for people that are just would like to do this as a hobby or just interested in looking for fossil. The organization, Paleontological Belgium, is organizing this event, is one of them. There are many of them around. So if you don't know where to start, just start talking to them, become a member, and you will be updated with all the news about that.
Good. I think that's very sound advice. I do apologize, by the way. I can't see a thing from here. I'm like a blind man. Sorry. This is why you should never assume gender. Now, maybe one ultimate question from the audience. Very last one. Thank you for listening.
Yeah, I'm hearing the same question from the people behind me, but they don't dare ask it. It goes as follows: what's your favorite dinosaur? But we just learned that question is a little stupid, so I'm just gonna make it a little more breed. What's like your favorite creature, or even plant, or fungi, as we talked about, that you have found, or that you have read about, that was
that lived long ago. Voilà.
That could be a question for everyone.
Yes.
You're going to make us choose?
You have to.
Mine has to be right now Murisnetia, which is a small type of seed plant that we find here in the Dinos area in Belgium, and is a very rare plant, one of the first vascular plants ever to conquer continental land and grow from there. But all the other plants that were around at the time were all distributing spores reproduce themselves. And this was one of the first plants that actually evolved seeds, and it was this tiny, really rare thing to find in these layers of that age. And so when we find it, we're super happy because all the other spore plants die out and they take over in the following geological periods, and that makes it really, really special. So what is the idea for you?
I never found anything. Besides rocks and snails in my garden. Happiness, yeah. But I like the baby from the dinosaur series. Like,
not the mama!
So that's my answer.
I actually love a dirty joke, I'm not going to say. I used to hate that question because I didn't work on dinosaurs, but I like the caissons just because they're so odd and sharks.
For me, it would be Triceratops, because it was around when an asteroid hit, so it was, you know, it could have seen it coming. That's a fun fact. And also because we were actually working on a large Triceratops bone bed in Wyoming, which is also a cool study bed that actually can give some potential information on how these animals were living, maybe in groups and so on.
Can you specify if the question was which is your favorite prehistoric animal or which is the favorite one you found?
I just asked a little stupid question, but I like how you have been answering, so you can interpret it as large as you want.
Well, I haven't found the iguanodons, so I did cut up quite a few of them. Papers in preparation.
This is being
live streamed.
I find that the giant robots are still, I don't know, because they're so awe-inspiring. They're huge. They're enormous. No animal has ever gotten this big, and it's just a walking flat, you know, whale on land, moving around. That's just fascinating. The earth must have trembled every step they took. And people ask me, kids ask me sometimes, which is the most dangerous dinosaur? I get out of the way for the big herbivores. Yeah.
Step on you.
The carnivores you can predict, they want to eat you, but the herbivores, you don't know what they're going to do, so probably more dangerous.
They probably won't even see you.
Yeah. Size matters for you.
He said it. So yeah, I won't say Triceratops because that one already passed. I don't have a favorite. I refuse to choose. It's like picking your favorite child. It's not fair. I would say my favorite find is that very odd jaw that I found last year. But the problem is I have no idea to this day what it is. So to be continued.
Good. I very much prefer a fun guy. Well, I think this...
You're a fun guy.
I'm blushing. <blushed. laughs> But since we are running late, I think we must unfortunately conclude our Q&A here. I think nobody will go home with any questions left. Our thirst has been quenched. Just leaves my thirst rambling. Now, it hasn't been dynamite evening indeed, but I have to say, that's all folks for tonight. All that is left for me is to acknowledge and thank all the first-class people who made this delightful event light reality. Koenstein, Harald Seelink, Anthony Hellebolt, Melanie Durin, Pim Kaskas, our superb orchestra, and of course, all the way from the United States, Professor Chris Shelton. Give them all a round of applause. Find your way home safe and sound. And might I already wish you all happy holidays and my best wishes for a dino-licious 2024. Thank you for coming, everyone. Good night. And of course, Frederick LaRouche. Can't forget, he has done his very best tonight.